Okay, we'll call this meeting to order, the Brawley City Council and successor agency to the Brawley Community Redevelopment Agency. This is our special meeting agenda, Tuesday, April 5th, 2016, early evening, 5 p.m. Could we get the roll call, please?
The minutes will reflect all council members present.
Very good. If we can all stand for the invocation, and we'll have Councilmember Noriega.
Almighty God, you are our creator and our sustainer. You are our light and our fortress. You are our wisdom and our strength. We ask for your guiding hand to lead us through this meeting. May we approach our tasks with wisdom, and may we approach our members with respect. May our conduct create an environment of cooperation and kindness. Thank you for helping us to accomplish our work this day. We ask these things in your powerful name. Amen.
Amen. And if Councilmember Nava can lead us in the Pledge Allegiance.
Ready, begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Councilmember Nava and Councilmember Noriega, for the invocation. And we'll go to our first item, item one, approval of the agenda. Do we have a motion to approve? We have a motion. Do we have a second?
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any noes? No votes, no abstentions. Motion carries. We'll move on to item two. Item two is our public appearances and comments. This is not to exceed 4 minutes. This is the time for the public to address the council on any items that are not appearing on the agenda that is within the subject matter jurisdiction of the city council. The mayor will recognize you when you come to the microphone. Please state your name for the record. You are not allowed to make personal attacks on individuals or make comments that are slanderous or which may invade an individual's personal privacy. Please direct your questions and comments to the city council. And under our public appearances and comments, item A, I would like to start with the presentation and proclamation in honor of National Library Week. That will come up this April 10th and will run through the 16th. And with that, we have Marjo Mello, our librarian. Do you want to start first? I was going to read the proclamation, but I can do that after.
Okay, either way works.
I think you're queued up and ready.
So. I can't, and semi-blind.
You're semi-blind. Oh, I think next to it.
There you go. See, that's what I said.
Yeah.
There we go.
And then keep going. Right there.
Yes.
Nice. Look at that.
Whoa.
Good job.
You still have it.
Libraries is misspelled, but it's not.
Libraries is okay to misspell. It's public that you don't want to misspell, and I'll let your imagination go. Bad Marjo.
Yes.
Okay.
It's not.
Libraries Transform is the theme this year for the American Library Association, and we have some. I bet that if I did the arrow, it would go. No.
I think if you just
left
scroll down.
Click.
Yep. If you scroll
there
down,
we go.
Yep.
Okay. Libraries Transform. And I'll let somebody read this other than me. Would maybe one of my library members have to read this?
Because transformation is essential to the community we serve.
And another person?
Because there are more than 14 million search results for the 2016 presidential election.
Wow.
Because more than a quarter of U.S. households don't have a computer with an internet connection.
Or know how to use PowerPoint. Okay.
Because the world is at their fingertips and the world can be a scary place.
Especially for children.
Because employers want candidates who know the difference between a web search and research.
Oh, interesting.
That's a good one.
Because learning to read comes before reading to learn. Because punctuation without imagination makes a sentence, not a story.
Because 5 out of 5 doctors agree reading aloud to children supports brain development.
And from a doctor, that is cool. Okay, this is the hard one.
because texts are fine, but
seriously, people
also need to see real sentences.
And libraries transform.
Very good.
Thank you. So you can tell that some of you don't use texting very much.
Or write.
Or if you come to the library, we can help you with that.
And Marjo, if I could, just for the potentially the listening public that may not have heard, that was those were members of our library board that were reading, and it kind of impresses me because there are also many of them were educators. So it kind of takes me back a little bit. So I felt, I'm being read to. Now the pressure's on me because now I have to read in front of the board. But that was a wonderful presentation. So no pressure here. So if I may do the honor here, and I'm going to read for a matter of public record here our proclamation in honor of National Library Week, April 10th through 16th, 2016. Whereas libraries are not just about what people have for people, but what we do for and with people. Whereas libraries have long served as trusted and treasured institutions, and library workers and librarians fuel efforts to better their communities, campuses, and schools. Whereas librarians are evolving in order to serve the communities and to continue to fulfill their role in leveling the playing field for all those who seek information and access to technologies. Whereas libraries and librarians open up the world of possibilities through innovative programming, such as LAMS vehicle, free one-on-one assistance for adults who would like to improve their English language reading skills, and classes for basic computer skills, job-seeking resources, and the power of reading. Whereas libraries and librarians are looking beyond the traditional roles and providing more opportunity for community engagement and deliver new services that connect closely with patrons' needs. Whereas libraries support democracy and effective social change through the commitment to provide equitable access to information for all library users, regardless of race, ethnicity, creed, ability, sexual orientation, gender identity, or socioeconomic status. Whereas libraries and librarians, library workers, and supporters across America are celebrating National Library Week. Now, therefore, be it resolved that I, Donald L. Wharton, Mayor of the City of Brawley, California, proclaim National Library Week, April 10th through 16th, 2016. I encourage all residents to visit the library this week and explore what's new at your library and engage with your librarian, because you, libraries, transform. In witness whereof I hereunto set my hand and cause the seal of the City of Brawley to be affixed on this fifth day of April 2016. And Marjo, if I may, what I'd like to do is, before I bring this down, go ahead and announce and introduce to the public our library board.
I'd love to introduce our board.
Please.
Thank you. We have Judy Grant, who is our secretary. Come on up. Yeah. Get your picture taken with the proclamation. Okay. Yep. We have Elizabeth Lorenzen, who is our library board president. We have Dr. Ron Stillman, who's a member and a retired dentist. And we have Dixie Smith, who has dual roles. Not only is she on the Library Board of Trustees, but she is our Friends of the Library president and responsible for having our great bookstore open.
Yes.
And raising lots of money that's used in the library. So she has a dual role. And Diana Lohr, who is really happy to help with book selection on adult nonfiction, because that's her favorite thing. And Council Member Noriega is our liaison to the library board, comes to meetings and helps us make sure things get done and gives us advice about city things that she can help with, and we really appreciate her.
Thank you.
And for the record, I was the former liaison.
Yeah, that's fine.
And actually, our city manager also puts two posters
Because you can.
That'll teach you.
These chairs. I cursed a good chair. I marked mine with an X. I cursed a lot of my chair. Just to get the name of that tequila for me, too. Remember. Every time I see it.
Great job, Scotty. Great job.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
And in honor of National Library Week, this Saturday from 9 to 1 on Main Street, the Main Street side of the library, we're going to have a book sale, and there's lots of good stuff. And then next Tuesday evening at 6 at the Main Library, we have a social worker coming in to talk about alcohol addiction because it's a main factor in the Ivy Reads book. Ivy Reads is a program where all local public libraries encourage everybody to read the same book at the same time. We're all reading Girl on the Train by Paula Hawkins. And Dixie Smith brought in a whole bunch of really cool train-related things in our display case, so please drop by and see those. And again, Tuesday night, we're having the program. So thank you all so much. I know everybody in the room is a huge library supporter, and we appreciate you. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Good luck.
And Marjorie, one last thing for the record. I set a New Year's resolution of reading, getting back to reading as many books as I can. So I think I've knocked out about 18 titles so far this year.
Good.
Yeah. I was going to say.
Well, he's always in the plane.
You can that's exactly. She is exactly right. So it's making use of that idle time.
Ignore the people that are sitting next to you every day.
Yeah.
Who's flying the plane?
That's right.
Autopilot.
That's right. Very good. So we are still under public appearances and comments. Do we have any members of the public that would like to come up and make a public comment for the record? Seeing none, we'll move on to item 3, which will be our consent agenda. Items here are approved by one motion. Council members or members of the public may request consent items be considered separately at a time different, determined by the mayor. Do you have a motion to approve the consent agenda?
Mr. Mayor, I would make a motion to approve the consent agenda as written.
I'll second.
We have a motion, we have a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any noes? No noes, no abstention, motion carries. We'll move on to regular business. Regular business 4A, and there is an amendment, if I can make, for the record. 4A reads currently discussion and potential action to approve request by Inferno to consume, but it will actually be changed to sell and consume, so sell and consume alcohol on a city street on Friday, April 15th, 2016, from 3 p.m. Currently it reads 12 a.m., but this has been amended to 1 a.m. For the record for April 16th, 2016 for the Snoop Dogg event. And we have our Parks and Rec Director, Ms. Pat Dorsey.
Yes, good evening, Mayor, Councilman. The City of Brawley Parks and Recreation Department requests that the City Council consider Inferno's use of city property for Snoop Dogg event scheduled for April 15th, 2016 from 3 to 1 a.m. in the morning. Inferno is requesting the North Plaza Street closure and permission to consume alcohol on City Street. A total of 1,000 tickets have been sold, and the event is anticipated to attract a large gathering, primarily inside of the defined and potentially in North Plaza Park. The applicant has met with the City Fire, Police, Public Works, and Parks and Rec Department. Special conditions in confirmation with the above reference were developed and agreed to by the event applicant. And then we list the what is really a stipulation that we would like to see performed from the applicant.
I did have a question.
Absolutely.
With respect to this particular event, it is a large-scale event. There is alcohol that is going to be consumed, and public safety is always, you know, a concern. Is mm-hmm. there sufficient security that will be present at the location?
I believe there will be, and we're requiring, I think it's one security guard per 100, and then we have a few of our department. And Chief, would you like to say a few words?
Yes. There was a public safety concern with the size of event, with the consumption of alcohol. We do have a detailed of officers that will be not in the event, but in the surrounding areas, primarily for the peace, keeping the peace, and to assist with any exiting of the patrons at the end of this event. So there has been some stipulations put in that we would like to see as far as having their own private security plus our own detail out there as well. So we've done some research on this event in other venues and feel that at this point that's appropriate.
Thank you. Will that lead to additional overtime on the officer's part?
Yes, it will.
This indicates 5 officers overtime. Is that what you...
1 supervisor and 4 officers, yes. Okay.
Mr. Mayor and Council, yes. I did want to make note that we did incorporate all of the conditions that were part of a multi-department review. Mm-hmm. We have not yet received the insurance documentation, which was requested by no later than Friday of last week, which was immediately prior to posting. So we'll be working with the applicant to hopefully get that in sooner rather than later, because we'd be unable to proceed with the event in the absence of the insurance.
Insurance is important. Yeah, I'm good again.
Understood. And any other council questions on this particular event?
No.
And there's...
When you make a motion, do you have to say Snoop D-O-double-G or just Snoop Dogg?
No, I think
I think it's on the record correctly. I do see that. I noticed that detail.
Snoop.
So do we have a motion?
So move.
We have a motion. Do we have a second? I'll second. We have a motion, a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Not in favor? No noes, no abstention. Motion carries. Provided, I'm sure, the requirement of the insurance is met.
Needs to be met.
We'll move on to item 4B. Yes, if you have
that will be on the record, right? As far as provided that the insurance is...
Sure.
Happy to take that. That's direction.
Yes.
Item 4B will be discussion and potential action to approve the request by the Brawley Chamber of Commerce to sell and consume alcohol on a city street in North Plaza Park on Saturday, April 16th, 2016, from 4 p.m. to 8 p.m. for the Farmers Market and Brawley Burger Battle.
I make a motion to approve.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? No discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Not in favor?
Thank you.
We have no noes, no abstention. Motion carries. We'll move on to
just
4.
Clarification. Does that mean that the farmers market is moved to that Saturday, not this coming Saturday? Is that correct?
That is that the is correct. Last farmers market of the season, and in light of temperature changes, there was a desire to give a different time of day a shot for the month of April, and hopefully we'll have great weather cooperating into the evening hours.
Right. Yep. Okay. Thank
that
you.
Might be best.
Next, we'll move on to item 4C. This will be discussion and potential action to approve a request by the Anthony Garcia Foundation to sell and consume alcohol on city property located on Main Street on April 30th, 2016, from 10 a.m. to 10 p.m. for the Cesar Chavez Community Celebration.
So move.
We have a motion. Do we have
I'll
a
second?
Second?
I'll second.
Any discussion, any questions?
I had a question.
Sure.
Is that, in the past, there's been another organization that's also sponsored that. Would this be the Anthony Garcia Foundation solely responsible for the sponsorship? Is that what it is?
Yes,
as far as I know. In the
past, it has been the Hidalgo Society.
Right, or a couple of different organizations have done this, but for this one, it's just the
Anthony Garcia Foundation.
Okay. Just had a question because I hope that was all I saw. So.
Yeah, it used to be the Institute for Social
Institute and also Hidalgo, I think, had done that maybe a couple times in the past. Okay.
All right, so we have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Not in favor? No, no abstentions. Motion carries. We move on to item 5A. This will be the General Fund Workshop Discussion and Staff Direction. Just as our city manager is getting ready, this is council's opportunity to in a workshop forum, so I think we'll move more into, if you have questions, comments at any time, feel free to address staff or city manager as we move along, and this will be focused on our general fund.
Right. Good evening, Mayor and council members. We've got a brief PowerPoint presentation, including some department level content that we would like to share with you this evening. I would like to encourage you to follow with the PowerPoint slides, and there's also copies here available for public and staff, as well as our budget worksheets that are the basis for the figures that are presented in the content. And our illustrious finance director will be available for additional detail if needed. So this is meeting number 3. In our budget process for next fiscal year. We started with the mid-year budget review. We followed with the strategic planning workshop, and tonight is solely focused on the general fund, which houses many of the functions of city government here in Brawley. So our hope for tonight is that we can share with you the framework and assumptions with our best numbers associated for revenues and expenditures. Our goal is always to be conservative in our revenue projections and realistic in our expenditures for known obligations. We did receive feedback from two members of the council at our last workshop that there was a desire to hear more at the department level. So you're going to see more detail this evening than has typically been a part of the process. Please let us know if we're burying you in too much, because the intent is to try to keep it policy level and out of maybe too fine a detail. But I think as we show you the framework that we utilize, you can start to see how the budget takes shape for each fiscal year. So, you know, this evening you're going to get to hear from every single department with their wish lists, which unfortunately often outpace the revenues available. But they're a great way to see the creativity that we would love to bring to the city of Brawley and the different ways of approaching problem solving that might be possible in the future. We're looking for your feedback. So if we're on track, we'd love to hear it. If you'd like to see us look at different ways of doing things, we're certainly open to it. None of this is set in stone. The intention is always to kind of focus on maintaining service levels or improving service levels in the next fiscal year. And your questions and comments are always welcome. Okay, so our overall approach, as described, is to maintain the existing service levels. Any place that we can, we're trying to hold back on the notion that we're going to erode the service levels that are being provided. But you're going to see how challenging this can be, given our fiscal constraints. We do have known expenditure increases, and we'll outline some of those knowns that are the cost of doing business increasing. As we heard in the State of the City address and many communications coming out of the assessor's office, we have new property valuations that were adjusted for our city, so we've tried to adjust for those new revenues and be realistic and conservative in those projections. I have met one-on-one with our departments. The finance director has also met one-on-one with our departments. And what we've attempted to do in the skeletal budget that is presented tonight is identify critical needs and high-risk topics, because you know, unfortunately, our revenues don't always match all the needs that we have. So we have to prioritize which are the things that are most critical for the city to address. A number of years ago, following the opening of Fire Station Number 2, the council adopted the concept of hiring one firefighter every year for 4 years to attempt to staff Station Number 2. This is the 50% plan to staff Station Number 2, but it has allowed for growth in our staffing levels during an incredibly frugal, the need for frugality in our city's history. So you're going to see what exactly that means when we look at body counts that have been part of our general fund operations. It was the rare addition to staff during very, very lean times. Unfortunately, I had really great expectations for next fiscal year, hoping that we could potentially look at the translation of full-time temps that we're utilizing in our day-to-day operations at the city, that we could look at converting them into permanent staff. Unfortunately, we were not able to accomplish that in these estimates that are presented to you this evening, but I would be remiss if I did not emphasize that we rely on full-time temp assistance in two maintenance worker positions at the Parks and Recreation Department, the Senior Center Coordinator, a very active staff member and set of services that we offer at our city facility. We have four expected regular full-time firefighters that will be deemed continued as temporary to keep staffing our operations, and we have a graffiti abatement worker that has been with the city for a couple of years, a very skilled painter, who unfortunately we were unable to transition into a permanent position as a part of the assumptions. So I just want to make sure, I know in my one-on-one conversations with council members, I always bring up these folks. Wait a minute, we've got these folks on hold, hoping that someday we can bring back permanent staffing to these temporary solutions. And as the Affordable Care Act has rolled out, we have found that retaining the temporary full times is not exactly the low-cost scenario that had been originally envisioned. So while they keep us whole during lean times, I'm hoping someday we can make them a part of our permanent operations. Okay. So this is kind of the doom and gloom slide that I just need to lay out as groundwork for council. We are in the midst of a payment plan for our Regional Water Quality Control Board settlement. And this coming fiscal year, we will make the fourth installment to the regional board, and we will have a number of payments remaining. This number really does affect how we end, how our year end looks on any fiscal year, because if we had come out ahead in a fiscal year, we're still making a large payment to this $1 million sum that we're obligated to pay. This next fiscal year, we have received estimates of a $70,000 increase in our Joint Powers Insurance Authority contributions. We do have a payment plan that's expiring that was part of retro payments as we transition in that schedule to prospective payments. The retro we were in a transition for. One of the retro payments went away, but on the other end of the spectrum, we had a $70,000 increase as a result of experience in the larger pool. So I want to make sure that you know that. As this council is very well aware, we have pension obligations, and we have been informed for next year that our employer contributions are going to be changing. Now, what this means in essence is for every dollar that a staff member earns, we have an obligation to set aside for their future retirement. This council was very active in ensuring that employees join the city and making contributions to their pension. And we went through some very significant changes in terms of contributions in the last 3 years. And so the good news is that today, you know, our employees are joining the city in investing in their pensions, but the cost of the portion that's carried by the city has increased. So as was described at our strategic planning meeting, on the safety end of the universe, which is our sworn personnel on the fire and PD, in the fire and police departments, those contributions on the employer side only are going from 42% to 48%, which means for every dollar earned, we are matching it with an additional 48 cents on every dollar earned. On the miscellaneous side, we're seeing an increase of approximately 2%. And as the council was advised at mid-year this year, we don't find out about our CalPERS medical adjustments until December for January 1 premiums. So as we wrestle with the obligations of the Affordable Care Act, we can only imagine that insurance premiums are not decreasing, they're very likely to increase. And those numbers have not yet been accounted for in this budget. So very likely we will be coming to the council in the future with a budget adjustment even after this 16-17 budget is adopted. And then last but not least, we all strive to provide the highest level of service possible with the resources that we have. And our experience has been that the public doesn't have any desire to see it decreased. They like to see it improve. And so this is one of the realities of day-to-day operations in the city, that we're, you know, trying our best in a fiscally constrained environment to deliver those services. Okay. So major considerations, just two items, want to kind of keep at the back of your heads. We are currently in the midst of labor negotiations with our four bargaining units. None of those changes are accounted for in this budget as it's presented to you this evening for your discussion and dialogue. There are no merit increases that are assumed. There are no healthcare related benefit adjustments. There are no reclassifications. None of those things are assumed in this budget. We also have a policy on the books that we want to make sure council remembers, which is our rainy day fund. This is the 15% set aside of all expenditures on an annual basis. And so we hope to be able to maintain that policy in the next fiscal year.
And the reason for them not being on the budget?
It's not negotiated.
It hasn't been negotiated yet. And I'll show you exactly where. But
we'll come back and stick it in there somewhere.
When the agreements are settled, they will be incorporated into the budget.
Okay. Thank you.
Uh-huh. By council action. Okay, so here is our proposed budget by department. And we put this slide together so that we can begin to identify exactly how is the pie broken up amongst all of our various departments and divisions. And you'll see in looking through the list, you know, one of the things that is always quite striking is looking at how the general fund is divided amongst the departments. And we know, based on the feedback that has been given consistently by this council, that public safety is the number one concern and number one priority for the city of Brawley. And when you look at the combined values of what we assign as resources to both police and fire, you'll see that, you know, it's kind of that term, follow the money. It helps to show where your priorities are demonstrated. And in this instance, you can see that both PD and fire comprise more than 50% of our city's general fund budget. And one other value that I think you can see very well demonstrated in the city's allocation of resources is how we view quality of life in terms of parks, recreation, and library. When you look at what our city devotes as resources, we hopefully have the opportunity in the future to continue to place the highest value on rec and programming for our community. And if you take a look at parks, the Rec and Lions Center budgets, rec leagues, senior center, library, and LAMS, some of those are grant funded with reimbursements. You'll see with the asterisks behind the LAMS bus, but a considerable sum, well over in the neighborhood of $2 million is devoted to those types of activities. You'll see on the admin front, I think there's always a question that comes up, you know, how much is the city spending on overhead? You can begin to see from the document processing where those major centers of activity are, what we are devoting as resources in those arenas. And I'm sure it's no surprise to you, because we often bring it up as staff, that we have a number of departments that are single people departments that have administrative responsibilities that are really important. And we have leaned many of these areas of the city in recent years, and I think done a pretty remarkable job with the resources that were available, even though in some places we downsized by 50% or greater in terms of the staffing associated with those admin functions. Okay, so this is a slide that shows over time the audit results for general fund revenues and expenses, and then some of our estimates. So I want to kind of just go through the last 4 years, or last 3 years, with a projection for next year. So at the closeout of fiscal year 14, the city came out positive at $155,630. At the close of 15, we came out ahead, and you just saw these numbers at your last council meeting when the audit was accepted. So these are our audited financial statements. We came out ahead $44,675. We are currently in the 15-16 budget year, and in that budget year, we estimated, and this is keeping excluding capital projects and the payments for the Regional Water Quality Control Board settlement, we estimate to come out ahead $123,206. And that will be tracked in the mid-year budget review and then in final audited financials that come to you next year at roughly this time. And we hope we can perform to that, although, as was shared with you at the strategic planning meeting, there were maybe some more aggressive or more optimistic sales tax projections that due to the price of gas dropping and the predominance of fueling stations as our sales tax generators, those numbers may have unfortunately been overstated. Okay, and in the budget that is ready for you this evening for your review and discussion, we have been able to maintain the same staffing levels that we have in place today. We've added that additional firefighter number 4 in year 4, but everything else has stayed the same. So anything that had to have an adjustment because we knew the Joint Powers Insurance Authority contributions were increasing, those things were accounted for, and we still came up just under 6,000 in the red. So we have some making up to do. Every workshop, we do have some making up to do. So I want to make sure that you know it's not the sky is falling. We are continuing to work with the County of Imperial on resolving some revenue projection topics. You know, that may come out as a positive for the city, I'm not sure. We have several topics that are still emerging. But I want to make sure I stop to emphasize that as it stands, with all other things being constant, we are still short the 6,000. Okay. So just stepping back to take an overall snapshot of how the general fund is carved up, we're just under 79% of the general fund is devoted to employee compensation. Now, over the last 4 years, we've seen this number decrease by about 4%, and it'll be really clear why when we look at the next slide. But you know, one of the questions always is, well, why can't we just spend less on supplies and materials or services? You'll see that compared to employee compensation, there is a cost of doing business. And in order for us to perform our work, our employees need equipment and supplies and you know, the tools necessary to be successful at delivery of the service. So this is intended to just kind of give you the bigger picture of how we carve up the general fund by types of expenditure. And this visual is particularly helpful in illustrating staffing levels. So in 2012, I joined the city of September of 2011. And at that time, we were in the 11-12 fiscal year. And at that time, we had 122 full-time employees devoted to the general fund. And there was a great deal of concern about expenditures exceeding revenues and a concern with living in our means. And as a result of the leadership of the council and the dissolution of the RDA, some very difficult decisions were made about living within the city's means. And you'll see from one fiscal year to the next, we had a very dramatic drop. of 7 full-time people, which honestly really does make a difference. And when we describe who those folks are, I think it'll be very clear, you know, why on some occasions we have service level reductions. This building alone had 3 additional full-time employees that were part of the day-to-day operations to answer the phones, to greet the public, to deal with public information requests, all kinds of subjects that enter the room and the building. We had a fire marshal that was partially funded through the general fund. We had a code enforcement officer, an economic development coordinator. There are quite a few folks that carried out very important work, but unfortunately we weren't able to retain those positions. And you can see since that time, in fiscal year 2013, we've taken a very conservative approach when it comes to staffing. And I'd like to explain some of the differences between the years that occurred beginning in 2014. In 2014, we kind of hit our lowest point at 111, or just under, and the reason they're in increments is because they're partially funded by other types of funds when we can reasonably establish a nexus. So the growth between fiscal year 14 and 15 is attributable to 2 police officers being assigned. You may recall right before Chief Gilmore retired, a application was successfully submitted for school resource officers. So we hired 2 additional individuals, and we're in a reimbursement scenario where the high school and elementary school districts pay for a portion of those officers, and the grants reimburse, the Department of Justice grants reimburse the city for their obligation. So that is representative of 2 of those staff positions that were added between 14 and 15. The addition beyond that is 1 firefighter a year for 3 years. And we're hoping to continue with that plan with year 4 of 4 in this next fiscal year. Okay, so with that, I have summarized the various city departments and wanted to let you know that staff was very much encouraged to develop wish lists. But unfortunately, the fiscal realities, I think all of us are very, very well acquainted with the constraints in which we operate. And I'm very proud of the efforts that have been undertaken by our finance department to make sure our department heads are very well acquainted. They own their budgets in a way that has not always been a part of our organization's history. They're responsible and accountable for those expenditures, and they very well appreciate the revenues that have been available to in the past. When there's an opportunity to utilize special funds, there is incredible teamwork that gets performed by this group. There's so much cooperation. It's encouraging during very lean times. So with that, what I would like to do is hand off in the order as listed, which is simply alphabetical, not prioritized in any fashion other than that, to give each of our department heads a chance to talk about their wish lists.
Good question.
I have a question prior to that, please. Yes. In going back, one of the earlier slides, with respect to the temporary positions that we've held for multiple years, at the senior center, there's a temporary position that's been there for quite some time, and there's also the graffiti abatement officer that we've operated with for at least 3 years now, I believe. And so did we do an analysis of what the cost would be fully burdened and what that would look like and what we're paying currently?
Yes, we did. I do not have it. I'm sorry I didn't pull graffiti abatement, and I'm going to just look to Ruby. She may be able to pull it for me relatively quickly. On the senior center coordinator, the difference between being a temporary full-time with Affordable Care Act related obligations fulfilled, as well as sick time, because now as of January 1, sick time accruals are the city's obligation. The senior center coordinator, the delta is $11,396 to go from temp to permanent.
That's the difference.
The difference. And on the maintenance, we have 2 maintenance workers that are full-time temps. Those individuals, the difference is approximately $22,063.
For both?
Per employee.
Oh, per employee.
Per, okay.
Per.
Per employee.
So it's 44.
No.
The other
one is 22.
And
they're twice.
Okay. So it's 44. Okay. Thank you very much. The difference for the abatement worker, $7,158. Thank you very much.
I think we need to make those two.
I had considered those positions for quite some time. I know council has as well, but considering the cost, I think we do need to look at seeing if we can absorb them as full-time employees. And I'm referring to the senior center position and the graffiti abatement position.
Only. Okay.
I had
is that a motion?
Couple of
no, that's just a comment. Just,
okay.
Yeah. I had a couple questions. One, you talked about your conservative estimates. This is a budget, and you know it moves all the time, and we have all these different scenarios that develop. You talked about conservative estimates. How conservative are you being? I mean, I just have that question, you know, because at the initial slide you said we're being very conservative about our revenues, but then, and then you're talking about us being 5,000 in the hole still, but if you're conservative on revenues, I would assume that we're going to pick up maybe $5,600 if all things being equal and things working through. We may have a balanced budget already. It's just based upon your estimates, it's not going to be quite that at this point in time.
Yeah, as we look through and we go through with the departments, they focus on expenditures and then we go through and do revenues. I primarily lead the role on the general revenues, which would be the first page of your handouts there. And we go through property tax, we go through the VLF swap, we go through sales tax swap, we go through utility user tax, we go through and do the admin allocation, which accounts for city overhead, central services within the city, engineering allocation, utility billing allocation, and look at basically, because those are shared costs amongst the other funds, and what I look at is how do we not want to over impact other funds as well, and making sure that the allocations are doing what they're supposed to do. Right. But we also go through and see, and primarily our significant sources are on page one, primarily your property tax. And we did, I went ahead and used a 10% factor due to the increases, because based on our mid-year review and even looking at through February as I'm putting these worksheets together and working with the departments, we have a 6% increase overall at this point in time comparative to last year. And there are, as shared with us, the cities and the adjustments, and with the Prop 8 and so forth, adjustments are now coming back to values increasing with that 2%. They're estimated an average of 2%. But based on our my review, it's been about a 6%. So going into the next year, I made a 10% assumption. The VLF swap, which is the next one, is basically comparative and a responsive office of assessed value as well. So that gave that the same incremental increase, 10% increase moving into the next year. So that I take the utility user tax. I take assumptions based on what I have control of, which would be water, sewer, and trash services, and what we can estimate as a city. What the other agencies provide for cable and gas and telephone, I mean, we make our best assumptions as on that type of activity, but we try to factor in a small percentage based on our adjustments that we made with the adopted new rates. So those are the conservative approaches, and if you'll see basically even in the audited financials, which were provided the last meeting, it gives you a budget versus actual scenario where you can see the fluctuations between, you know, what we adopted as budget and what we actually received based on year-end accruals and receipts of those types of monies. Again, I'm very, and I highlighted, which and was shared with HDL with us, is they provide us with their estimates for sales tax. And my last quarterly meeting with them, they did provide, you know, unfortunately, City of Brawley is going to have they're overestimated this year on their budget for sales tax. And they do a 60-day accrual. City of Brawley does a 30-day accrual. So I already adjust their projections that they provide to not count out 60 days to account for our 30 days. So I had already captured that slight difference. But this, again, going into the new fiscal year, we currently in the 15-16 have a $2.4 million projected revenues for 15-16, which is most likely not going to happen. That's been adjusted. And in the current proposed budget, I've adjusted that to $2.1 million. So basically it's just the trend, and then I rely on the departments for their department specific, the trend that they're seeing within their departments, may it be building, police, Engineering itself has an engineering allocation, so it's basically 100% cost recovery less any revenues received by the department for any other services that they provide. So we go through in any revenue streams that they have so we can account accordingly so we don't over tap the other funds. Library, Marjo's very good at providing me with the LAMS information, her grant information from the state, in order to make sure that that is, you know, in a strategy basically to keep the LAMS program whole. So all those things go into consideration.
And I guess you answered my question, but I think that when we talk about that, when we're looking at $5,600, you know, say that I don't really see that. I see that as a problem, but I don't see it as a major problem for us because of the issue of estimations. I mean, the whole budget is an estimation for the year, that we don't have a disaster, that we don't have something come up that could affect that in any way. Now, we do have to take into consideration anything that we do for employees in the future, any of those types of things where we might have some revenue declines or revenue increases, and so we have to kind of look at that. But I view the document as a budget, and it'll change, I think, as we move along. So I don't really see that as being a major negative to the whole process. A couple other questions. One, on the installment plan for the Regional Water Quality Board settlement, how much do we pay them yearly? And I've forgotten that, and I should know, but
it's $133,333.
Okay.
I'm sorry, what was that?
$133,333. So $133,333. Every July, we have to remit payment by July 1. They have special instructions on how we remit payment.
So you don't want to know how I feel about that, but I mean, and I won't say anything right now, but you don't want to know how I feel about that.
Yeah.
Well, I think we all know how we feel about that. I'm sorry, Remy.
Our first fiscal year where we faced the settlement figure, right, we made a payment of $333,000.
Right.
It was going to be split in 3 years.
Fiscal periods.
Yeah, yes, yep. 3 fiscal years. So, after the closure of National Beef, we reopened discussions with the regional board, and they allowed us to renegotiate the terms to a 5-year agreement. So we're making payment 4 so this next fiscal year, and then we'll have 2 years remaining after next year.
Okay, and my final question, I guess, was, We talked about in our strategic plan meeting last week, I guess it was. Mm-hmm. It seems like it was a long time ago, but we talked about our reserves.
Yes.
And how much we actually had in reserve versus how much as it relates to our policy. And what were those figures?
It was 34%.
It was a little bit over. It's $4,916,000.
Okay.
Is our general fund reserve balance at the close of 2014-15, and we needed to hold $2.4 million, based on current year expenditures, to meet the 15%.
That's our 15% reserve, and we certainly want to have more than that in reserve, and we want to make sure that we have that. But I also want to be clear that even though we're spending at this level, and even though we've got this going on, we still have a pretty healthy reserve. And so I think we should have a healthy reserve, and I agree with our policy of 15%, and it should probably be even more than that. Mm-hmm. But I do think we do have a healthy reserve built up, so I don't see some of that. You know, I see some of that as maybe we have to take some steps, as George had mentioned here, Councilman Nava had mentioned, about maybe some of the staffing and some of the things that we might have to do. And then I think we're going to hear some department wishes. We may have to go through some of those also. And then there's also some things in the back that we do for other contributions that we make. And I think we have to look through those and consider what we do this year. Okay, I'm good.
I just needed to clarify, Rosanna, on the one item that's hire one firefighter year 404. Has that been done already, or that's part of the plan for this fiscal coming?
What we're hoping for in the estimates assume is that year 4 of the 4-year plan would be implemented next fiscal year. So it's assumed the difference between this fiscal year of fiscal year 16 to 17, the difference is one general fund position, and that one position is the firefighter.
Okay. And is there any need to, or I'm just throwing that out there for consideration? I mean, I know the decision was made by the council to hire 4 and hire 1 every year, but I'm just wondering if maybe that's something we could look at as far as need, or Does the fire chief have anything that he'd like to share with us
on that? I think when you hear his wish list, you'll find out about the other four firefighters that he hopes to staff with.
Okay, all right. Okay. I'll wait for that.
So, but it is up to the council to decide whether or not you wish to add another person to the budget.
Right, okay. Right. So, yeah, when he does his presentation.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
So with that, we'll start with our city clerk.
Good evening, Mayor and council members. On my wish list, my number one priority is an administrative secretary for the administrative offices at a cost of $40,021 annually. Second is a reconfiguration of the administrative building to be more accessible to the public. A glass window installed at the office of the city clerk at a cost between $35,000 to $40,000. That includes professional services because we would have to hire an architect or engineer to come in, and it's the reason it's so expensive because it's a 1 hour firewall that we have currently. Right, and number three is LaserFish program upgrade at a cost of $10,000 that will benefit all departments with scanning and create a searchable database for everyone.
Getting back to your glass window, are you talking about
the wall?
What wall?
On the hallway.
The
on the hallway. Mm-hmm. The one in my
hallway.
Office. Where
okay.
The file cabinets are.
So uh-huh. That you, so the public could access, uh-huh. See you there. Oh.
There used to be one there. When,
a long time ago.
Yeah, courthouse was here.
Yeah,
that's
true.
So, any questions?
And
thank
I'm sorry,
you.
The item number three, a scanner, a laser scanner?
No, it's a laser. It's a program to upgrade a software. Software program.
And what was the cost of that?
$10,000.
Okay.
And you use
thank
that
you.
For?
Okay.
Sorry. You use that for the software?
To search documents. We scan resolutions, ordinances, city council minutes. So if we're looking for something, we just go into, like right now, the only departments that have, oh, the only department that has is it's myself, it's me and Lorena. So if we need to look for something, we just put in whatever we're looking for and it pops up. And if we do it this way, James, it's for three licenses, and we could use it. We just have to determine what department, like maybe the police department.
So for other departments?
Yes.
Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. For them okay. To have the capability of doing it there at their office.
So they won't have to come to you mm-hmm, for mm-hmm. Or Lorena?
Uh-huh, but they could do it on their own.
Okay.
I see.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so next is Francisco.
Good evening, Mayor Horton and council members. I apologize for getting a head start. I thought there might be a construction question.
No problem.
No problem.
Involved with the window that needs to go in the corridor.
Not yet.
Right. Community developments, I'm Francisco Soto, Community Development Services. The general fund concept that we would like you to consider today for community development is the staffing of one code enforcement position. Historically, the code enforcement officer was in the city of Brawley. Unfortunately, when the redevelopment agency funding was lost, that position was lost. The remaining staff actually does a pretty good job of taking care of code enforcement as far as response times and follow-ups. And a lot of that reason is because of the level of building activity that we were under. We certainly were not at the level of activity that we were in 2003 and 2004. So the slack was well taken up. We were responding very well. Since then, there's been an uptick in building activity. We compare the building activity between 2013 and 2014, it's fairly flat, but in 2015, the number of building permits increased in the amount of approximately 30%. And the valuation assigned to the buildings that cover those building permits almost doubled from about $12 million to about $22 million. In addition to that, several new activities were taken up by both the code enforcement, where we're first responders for any code enforcement issue, and then we either handle it or pass it to the appropriate department, and other items such as construction work needed by city buildings. We've been successful at being able to develop scopes of work for that and then service construction managers from the deteriorated foundation to this building, to the handrail up front, to the scope of work for fire station number 2 windows and construction manager for that. And it included last year, if you'll remember, a myriad of air conditioning installations all over the place. So we developed a scope of work for those, and we went ahead and did construction management on that. So that takes a little time. Because of the upswing in activity, I've noticed that we are still handling the noticing and the follow-ups on code enforcement, but we are taking a little more time to do. In addition to that, it also eats up a little bit of the plan checking time, which, as you know, the faster we do the plan checks, the more building permits get issued and the rotation remains. So because of this, and we don't see a slowdown in that activity for 2015. As a matter of fact, we have 2 industrial existing businesses. One wants to expand, one wants to do a major renovation. La Valencia subdivision, which had 23 lots to construct, is almost to the end of it. But just today, we got plans for 3 model homes for La Victoria subdivision at Malin Street and 2nd. They have 61 lots to build. Florentine is going very well. Their marketing strategy said that they were going to be building individual condos, but in fact, this year, they have 2 multiple condos also being built. So things are looking potentially so that they are going to remain at least at this activity. Because of this, and because we don't want to lose any ground in being able to follow through with code enforcement, which requires first contact, then several notices, legal noticing, then we would like you to consider that staff position.
The
fully burdened cost would be how much?
Approximately $137,000. That would include salary, furniture and office equipment, fuel and maintenance, and a vehicle.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions for Mr. Soto?
Thank you.
So thank you.
The only clarification, Mr. Soto, is that, you said, you've pretty much have been handling it, but things are kind of getting behind.
They're not quite behind yet. We're taking a little longer. We're still meeting good time periods. But if the activity ticks up, we're going to start losing ground. And we're not as fast as we used to be in the follow-up. Code enforcement lives on perseverance and documentation. You have to, once you establish that that's a problem, you get the building sealed, and then you have to go back over and over so that it doesn't slide back. All the foreclosures, you're talking to somebody in the Midwest who doesn't understand that Imbrali is one of the parcels he bought in a lot of 1,000 foreclosures and really doesn't care that he needs to follow up. So we're constantly looking for new owners and looking for owners to have responsibilities for that.
Okay. How many employees do you have right now?
We have 5 employees in the Community Development Department, including the department head.
So that includes you.
Francisco, is there such as... we're going to throw this question out, but Mayor Pro Tem Couchman brought it up. Is there such a thing as a part-time code enforcement?
Yes, that would be something that could be looked at also.
Right. Okay.
Sure.
I know there's contract services that provide code enforcement assistance, but I know that there's also issues with contract services.
That particular issue was before you because our contractor acted a little too rashly in some council people's opinion on one of the abandoned vehicles, if you'll recall.
I do recall. It was Council Member Miranda. The oldies. The cars, I remember.
Yes. This is an interesting thing. I mean, is it a full-time temporary? We could look at a lot of different options, I think, if we were going to consider that, I think.
Typically have citation authority. That's the form that it took in the prior life here.
Citation authority. And, And I think it was previously occupied by a former law enforcement officer.
Yes, and it worked out very well.
There were some things that went along with that.
Worked out very well.
In the lean times that we experienced, we actually took the vehicle that was once assigned to the code enforcement officer and repurposed it in our city operations. So it's no longer housed inside of Community Development Services, which is why a new vehicle is proposed to support this position.
And would a new vehicle be necessary, or could we repurpose a city vehicle?
If there was a city vehicle available,
we haven't been able to. We tried to do that with our Parks and Rec department.
Right, right.
Because oftentimes they've been the recipient of older vehicles, or gently used.
Gently used.
So we have exercised all those options. We don't have any excess vehicles. We're actually operating in a shortage.
Okay.
Vehicles available for
us. That's the questions we have to ask when we have to know these things. That's what we're really looking
for. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you.
Thanks, Francis.
Good evening, Mayor, City Council members, Ruby Walla, Finance Director. The list I put together is a small consolidated list, but my number one priority, which is big ticket item, is a rehabbing and remodeling of the utility billing lobby and department area, which would be if we redo the lobby. As you know, the building is very old, which we have ADA issues as well. If you've ever visited our lobby, it's very small. So like on the 15th or the 22nd or on our busy days or even the first of the month, lines are out the door. We fit maybe about four people in there at a time. But we have found that, you know, a reconfiguration would be good. And basically we've had the chiefs come by and looked at it about a year ago, but we're estimating that at least $250,000. That's without having someone actually come out and look at it, but we've been throwing the topic around, even just a staff on how we reconfigure and proper space planning, how to accommodate. Our wish would be to have two windows as they are to attend to utility billing issues, and then have a separate window for business license processing, because there's lots of times when we have new signups or whatever it may be, we can take them aside or a business license application and explain things to them. So that would be our hope to do that one day, which would also include security enhancements or anything for the counter, just the proper space for ergonomically correct workspaces. And that goes for the counter as well throughout the department. So we find that, or I find, if we were to move forward with a remodeling of that area, it would then push to, you know, do space planning, appropriate space planning within the department. The second request would be to restore the frozen position of the senior accounting assistant position, which would then, my department currently with utility billing and finance is a total of seven, including me. So this would be number eight, and this would be reintroducing the senior accounting assistant position, which we lost the senior accounting assistant. And what we did is basically we froze that position. What this would allow is for the utility staff to maintain at the counter, to handle business license processing, to handle parking citations, to handle reconciliations that are needed for actually audit review processes with aged accounts, to handle the shutoff listing and stay more on top of that and have more accuracy when handling shutoff lists. To handle the day-to-day reconciliation reports once the utility billing supervisor has processed that work on water deposits. That's something that we aim to do as accounts become eligible for refund of their water deposits, just to monitor that more closely.
What's the cost
for to reinstate that position would be $52,380.
That includes benefits?
Correct.
So when was that position eliminated? Do you know more or less? Like how many years ago?
Last fiscal year.
Oh, so it's been gone a year. And so the work that person did?
We kind of restructured the department and we shifted employees and we did some cross training. So actually we have three accounting assistants right now and one senior accounting assistant. The goal of the department prior just the changes within the city was to have two senior accounting assistants, and that senior accounting assistant, this would allow for a promotion as well, in essence, which would be embedded. So we have currently an accounting assistant not at the utility billing counter. They share responsibilities, but however, they process AP, they serve as a back to the utility billing supervisor, they assist with payroll, they serve as support to the girls, to the staff at the counter, opening and closing, balancing cash deposits. So basically right now staff has now shared duties. So either supervisors have taken on some of the responsibilities, or other accounting assistants, we have diversified the duties just to kind of share them. What we find is adding that person back in is that it would help us streamline some of the processes, especially what we've, and I've shared this before, is metering. Since the city's on a metering system, that's much more detailed work and more evasive, in the sense that when someone cancels services, we have to put in a work order, get an actual reading, wait for that reading to come back. In the past, when it was just a flat system, it was half the month, whole month, just the direct charge. Now we have to make, you know, charge the customer for their usage, not someone, and we ensure that. So it just takes, there's a lag in the system. And sometimes when we have, especially tenants, and they've provided the city with a deposit and they want a refund, well, we can't refund until we close out their account properly. So there's a lag in that sense, and it would be redirecting so someone can focus on business license, because we have found the need, especially as businesses have been coming in and with the requirements of metering, their locations, if they're not metering, just to properly track that and stay on top of that and coordinate. And that way, when someone calls to the city, they have a direct person they can be in contact with, rather than whoever picked up the phone. And kind of direct in that nature.
Okay. And that, the cost?
$52,380. And the other items listed were, we're in kind of in that, but we find the need for computer replacement, and as well office furniture replacement. It's just we've had some. In today's agenda had some identified items of excess furniture that we've kind of accumulated that are just basically have been stored there, old, heavy desks, not sufficient for the staff and their work load. So that's another recommendation as well. A request.
Was there a cost
on
that?
$16,000. Is that what, like new ergonomic desks?
It would be new desks and chairs.
Okay. Also computer replacement?
Computer replacement would be estimated at the same, about $16,000, depending on the type.
So 16 for each?
Yes.
Okay.
And those are my requests. Any questions?
Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor, Council Members. Chuck Peraza, Fire Chief. Some of the fun concepts I had put together, of course, the number one is probably the most important and the largest item. It's our self-contained breathing apparatus. And if I could explain that, it's almost like a scuba tank for a scuba diver. We wear those at all fires, toxic chemical releases, anything that's we're going to be breathing toxic chemicals, which is, I mean, it comes all the way down to a dumpster fire or a vehicle fire. We wear those pieces of equipment for all those types of incidents. Right now in our fleet, we have a mix match of these air packs that range from a 1995, 1997, 2003, and we have eight of them that are a 2008 model. So we don't have everything that's, you know, as a one component. So the bulk of those breeding packs are meeting their life expectancy. Usually the bottles last about 15 years, but we're starting to find out that these bottles are not meeting their hydrostatically tested, which is tested every 5 years. They fail, we have to put them out of service. So we're starting to lose units as each time we're testing them. The air packs themselves, we can upgrade them, but it's almost like a Band-Aid. And as the older models, we're finding that a lot of the parts are not available to upgrade those packs. So we have a big potpourri of these air packs, which are very vital for us to perform on incidents.
If I could interrupt and just ask, how many of these apparatus are you looking to?
32 of them.
And the cost?
If we were to replace all to them to a 2013, which is the upgraded model currently, the cost of them are roughly in the range of $6,500, which would probably bring us to the estimated of just over $200,000. Yes. 208.
Total for okay. The 32.
Yes. 8,000. For 32. What if we didn't replace all 32? What if we kept you with the 2008 model but replaced everything else?
The older ones.
Yeah, we would have to wind down the number from the eight
because they're $6,000 a piece for each one,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
$6,500.
So, but the problem is, if we were to replace the number minus the eight for the 2013, then the only time they really upgrade an addition is when standards change, when OSHA is mandating
right,
this,
right.
And we're mandated by OSHA and the National Fire Protection Association to have these. So the only time they really change is when they find a deficiency or a need to make a lighter pack, because these packs are weighing anywhere from 25 to 30 pounds, the current ones we have. The newer models, they're running about 10 pounds. So they're increasing our workload, and so we would probably almost get back into a mismatch, a potpourri of testing and things like that. But the eight would probably be the ones that we could probably stretch out another 8 years.
The only thing I'm thinking is that if we replace, the only thing I look at is having to replace everything all at once is $200,000. If we did some every year, then it wouldn't be as much of an impact on this existing budget as we have right now. That's why I'm kind of looking at that. If we replaced everything, but those eight that you have this year, and then we replace the eight the next year, then that pushes that over to the next budget. That's my only concern.
Yeah, no, that is a consideration.
That's my only concern. I'm not saying wait 8 years on the other ones. What I'm saying is replace the ones you need immediately, the real old ones, and then go to the new ones and then replace those as we move along, because it gives us a little bit more flexibility in terms of budget. That's the only thing. That's something I'm looking at. We want you guys to be safe. You know, we don't want to cut corners on fire and protection and all that, especially on the health of any of the firefighters. So we want to be real careful about that.
That is a consideration.
Would you say, because you said they dated back to 1995, and usually the life is 15 years?
Yes.
So how many of those would you say are beyond the good 15-year period?
Probably about 75% of them.
Yeah. Only the eight are probably...
The only eight that are probably we're holding on to. Okay.
And you bought the 2008 ones in 2008, I'm assuming,
yes.
When they were available. And,
yes.
And did we make that purchase all at once, or did we make it?
No, we made that purchase all at once, and that's about the year that we got the Quint.
Okay.
The what? Okay.
The Quint, a ladder truck.
Oh. So in essence, you need 24.
Yes.
Yes.
You at least need 24.
At least 24, yes.
I mean, if you kept the eight.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
And then moving on, you guys, you saw the overall approach slide that the city manager had. If we are able to graciously, with our hiring of our new firefighter for year four of four, I would like to have that type of pattern reinstated. That would leave me with four reserves still working as part-time, full-time firefighters. They're getting paid the 1114 because of the Affordable Care Act. They're accruing some sick leave, but they don't have the full benefits, and they're working hand-in-hand with our full-time firefighters. So in order to complete that package, I would like to see those four reserves that are working be hired one firefighter every year for the next 4 years. So the same type of pattern that we're on currently.
So after hiring the four of four, you'll still have four reserves right now?
Yes, if this firefighter for this year is hired for this fiscal year coming up, I'll still have four reserves.
You still have four reserves.
Yeah. So they're the full-time temporaries.
Chief, do you know what's the fully burdened cost of each firefighter?
I believe we looked at it and... Roughly just a little over 66,000 for fully burdened.
Chief is asking his wish list be considered for 2018 and 19 already. You got to start building that.
You got to pre-plan.
You got to bring it soon.
That's what public safety is, pre-planning.
That's right. I had a question, Chief. To go back to the breathing apparatus, does each individual firefighter have his own individual breathing apparatus, or do you guys check those out as you go to the fire, or how does that work?
They're all stocked on our apparatuses. So every engine, the ladder, the squads, and they're equipped on the seats where each firefighter is, including the captain. The only one that does not have it is the engineer or the driver of the, and then we have some on the side compartment. So if we have off-duty people come in onto a fire, they're available there for them.
But you don't always have everybody go to the fire, so not all of them are being used at the same time, maybe, possibly.
Yes, but those bottles roughly last 30 minutes, depending on the work time.
So you may have to have replacements.
You can switch out those. Okay. Yeah, we exhaust those packs in a matter of 30 minutes.
Okay, thank you.
And that's the people that are really in good shape.
Well, yeah, the other ones,
because you can down those bottles in about 10 minutes.
I would bet, yeah.
Depending on your workload, especially in the summer months. So.
Thank you for that clarification.
Okay.
And then... Station 1 exterior renovation. Of course, everybody's seen Station 1, and the deteriorating facelift is something that we would want to incorporate. I have reached out to SDK. SDK was the architect company that built the fire station number 2, as well as the EOC. Ran some quick numbers with Tony Finaldi, which is now, I'm happy to say, he's an actual partner for the company now, where he was a project manager. But he was graciously able to help me out and crunch some numbers real quick just to see what it would take to do the exterior for the stucco, the paint trim, maybe some wood replacement, just to bring the building up to something that's more attractive to people that are driving by and some of the other city buildings that we have here in the Brawley. We came to a figure of roughly $125,000.
I'm sorry, how much?
$125,000. And, you know, the last time that building was touched was something on the exterior was back in the 1980s when Jimmy Sanders had come in and did a renovation from the 1940 portion of the building and then did an addition to the back end, which is like the sleeping quarters and everything. So
1980.
So it's been quite a period of time.
So it would just be stucco paint, trim. Some wood trim being replaced.
Yes.
But complete exterior facelift, if you will.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then the final one is a new command vehicle. Currently, my fire marshal is working out of the old Chevy Tahoe, which Chief Contreras had purchased back in 2002, I believe it was. And It's on its last leg, so we're thinking about replacing that and getting a new command vehicle, which he would move right into, and it would suit his needs. I got it right here. Yes, it's roughly $47,300, and that's with everything with the emergency radios, emergency lighting. It's a basic... fleet model that we'd move into. It'd be a Ford F-250, which actually would meet our needs a little more down here, especially with urban interface with the river bottom. And this vehicle would also be deployed to strike teams, which I'm currently in the queue to start getting into those classes and taking the strike teams out when there's requested outside of the county.
Chief, thank you. If I could ask you a question, if you had to boil down your list to one item, what would it be? What would be your priority?
That's a tough one.
You got to be an answer.
You know, every fire we go to, we're exposed to carcinogens, and it's known that we're exposed to 27 carcinogens. And I would have to say the breathing apparatus replacement.
Thank you.
I think so.
I didn't mean to put you on the spot, but I just wanted to get clarification.
That sounds like,
because we're considering a lot of different things.
Sure, I understood.
I think he'd already said that was number one on his list.
So they're kind of in order of your priority.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
I would have to do that eventually.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
We're going to have to do that too. But
yeah.
What are we going to do?
There's no asset forfeiture for fire.
Good evening again. So. I get to talk about my favorite thing, which is the library. And I feel like a, let's see, what were they called? They had a song going, tell me what you want, what you really, really want.
Yeah.
The Spice Girls. Yeah, I kind of feel that way.
That's why Marjo.
Okay. That's a Marjo. Sorry.
Okay, anyway. Marjo.
Okay.
Chuck, you should open with that.
Yeah. So the ones that follow, yeah, right. You know, now you better be thinking of a song.
He's killed it.
He's killed it. Well,
and when we were given the assignment, I asked if I could have Richard Rubio come and do this for me, because a few years back, it was like between something I wanted and Richard wanted, and when we got done, I went, well, I'd give it to Richard too. So anyway, what I really, really want for the library is about $6,800 for a one-time purchase for some computer enhancement. It would cover 3 high-end laptops, and we really would like to move to having some more laptops, because we have an offer from the local AmeriCorps students to come in on Saturdays because they're required to work volunteer hours, and they could come in and work with people who would like to learn to keyboard and learn how to use the internet, use Google, set up email, etc. And having 3 laptops would mean that the classes, this really small group classes, could be held in the conference room, because another department has set up a really good Wi-Fi program for us with free Wi-Fi, so they could actually sit in there and use the laptops for that training. The other thing is, the library has a policy of 1 hour max a day on our public access computers. Once in a while, we have people who are doing job applications, homework, and whatever, and they need it longer than the hour. What we could do with a laptop is set them at another table with the Wi-Fi and let them actually use it longer than the hour policy that we have for our workstations. So there's lots and lots of uses for 3 more laptops. I would ask for 6, but 3 is more realistic with our budget constraints we have. The other thing is we have 2 CPUs at our circulation desk. One sometimes turns this incredible blue field of, what's it called, blue screen of death, and just gets restarted. Yeah, he's going, yes, okay. And then the other one is from the late, 2007, and it's we're afraid it's ready to go to the blue screen of death too. So we'd like to get 2 CPUs at our front circulation area. We also have a couple of monitors that are this big, and it would be really nice to have some that are this big.
How big again?
About this big. They're the 9-inch, whatever.
9-inch.
Yeah, a little 9-inch, and we
big screen.
At home, I have a 32-inch TV that I've set up with a USB that's my monitor at home. But I just want regular monitors at the library. So,
what's the cost?
Yeah. $6,800 total, because I'd also like to get some devices for ADA.
Is that $6,800
for everything?
For everything.
Laptops. That's not
for
your everything. Laptops, though.
No. $3,000 for laptops, $2,000 for CPUs. Okay. $1,000 for monitors, and that's probably high, and $800 for some ADA compliant devices where people with hand problems can use rollerballs and just miscellaneous things that we could use. And that's what I really, really want.
So the $3,000 for the laptops, that's each one, so that's not.
No, each one is one.
Okay.
So it's just $3,000 for all
it's
3.
$1,000
so it's $6,800 for Marjo's computer stuff.
Everything.
Okay. Everything in this. Okay.
Yes. And then my wish list for stuff that's really not realistic is, it really isn't yet. I mean,
yeah, we understand.
I see the budget. I mean, this is okay. But just things to keep in the back of your mind for a few years from now. We totally need our public restrooms redone. On the city's ADA report, our bathrooms are wonderful ADA examples from 1993. but not 2014 or 15 when they did the study. So to do all that, a big, really comfortable number to start with is about $125,000. Okay. Another one that you may have heard about is replacing a lot of the windows at the library. Mm-hmm. The children's wing, built in 1993, has double-paned windows. Everything else is a hodgepodge of broken pieces and whatever and put together, and it would be really nice to have that. And that, after the experience at the fire department, about $120,000 is a conservative estimate to do the windows at the library. Because each one, having gone through multiple earthquakes, has to be designed for each individual, because nothing is 6x4, it's 6 feet and 1/2 by
right.
3 inches. Oh, okay. And it's probably not square 90 degree corners shifting. Either. And then the other thing I'll bring up again is a electronic security system for the library. It'd be about $6,000 for the main library and about another $4,000 for the Del Rio Ranch branch. The Del Rio branch is only open 8 hours a week, so we're okay with not there, but I put the figure in just as an overall number. But for the main library, it's about $6,000. Yes.
I was going to say, is that for, did you contact somebody to get an estimate on how much
yes,
it costs?
Yes, the company is called Checkpoint, and each of our books already has what's called a teeny beeper inside, which it's magic to me, but they explain that it's radio waves, and our date card, when you check the book out, when you put it in there, it blocks the radio waves, so you can go in and out and it won't make a noise. If you have a book that hasn't been checked out, or you've decided to use the date card for a bookmark, it makes a noise and alerts to go off.
Okay.
We also put them on statues and paintings because we've had those removed before. So that's what it is. And if you go to Target, you can see the big white stands they have. They're about that mm-hmm. high, and they're plastic. That's exactly what it looks like.
Yeah, I've seen those in different places.
Yep, they have them in different stores. Bed Bath & Beyond has them, and now you know where I shop.
Okay. And we don't have that system currently?
No. We have the teeny beepers in the books. We're still putting them in there, but we don't have the stands to detect.
Okay. All right.
And that's the thing I didn't get when Richard Rubio asked for his lawnmower. So that just put that back in.
Lawnmowers are more important.
Yeah, it was. It is it with is. What they do.
If you got to cut the grass.
Anyway, so actually, all I really would like to have are my computer goodies.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Thank you.
Parks. And you want to know too, right?
Good evening. That's why I wanted to be first, because I knew that if I got up here first, maybe I could get something out of what Rosanna says is a wish list. All of it's a wish list, and a wish list, we know where that goes. But my three priorities would be...
Let's be optimistic.
That's why I put the swimming pool first.
Okay.
And we need new plaster. The plaster is chipped. When the kids swim, they cut their feet. The pool is utilized yearly. All Brawley schools take advantage of the pool. The end of the year parties, the beginning of the school PEs. Brawley Union High School conducts PE swim classes in the pool. We have year-round swimming through IVDA, AM and PM classes. One heater needs to be fixed, not operating, and both need heat exchangers replaced. And if you ask me what the number is of the replastering in itself, it's $500,000.
Damn.
I know. That's why I wanted to be first. But the mechanicals and the shed, that's where our strand troll tells us what we need, what chemicals we need, and how to balance everything. And to put the shed over the mechanicals so it make it worthwhile is $50,000. And those two go together. Our renovation of our restrooms around town. Mm-hmm. I believe they haven't been done in 20 years at least. They're quite scary.
Disgusting.
And they really need to be redone. We can do that in-house, but we would need the money and just going around. We've done some so far, but we would need about $50,000 to do all the restrooms. We can do so many 1 year, so many next year, but we really need to get started on that. Just so when the public goes in there, they won't have to see that. It's doom and gloom, and we can fix it up if we have the money.
Okay.
And I'm talking like at Weisfield, Beachy Field, Gonzales, Pat Williams, Rotary Park, Hinojosa, and Guadalupe Park. And those are our main parks, but you know, not every park has a restroom in the first place. But those parks, people are there, they're being utilized. The kids should be able to go in there and be comfortable, at least sitting on a toilet, and you know, just being comfortable using the restroom. I would like to see that happen. It's not my top priority because the pool is the priority. And my third wish is, yes, Marjo, it's a riding lawnmower, $20,000. We have two riding lawnmowers at the moment, but if one goes out, it would be a hardship on the existing one. So, you know, you put one up and you use one, but you always have one in the back if one goes out. You don't, and we do a lot of parks. Mm-hmm. We mow all week long, so we do need that riding lawnmower.
That's $20,000.
A John Deere riding
John
lawnmower.
Deere.
Those are my three wishes.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Questions?
Thank you.
Thank you.
I think they're in shock.
Not really. Personnel. Nothing shocking to me anymore.
Unfortunately, we have personnel and risk management. Shirley was unable to join us today because she's under the weather.
So, what is
I do know that she has two requests that she has regularly raised to my attention. One is a software solution that allows for the open enrollment period for January of each year when benefit election activities occur. She has requested the acquisition of software that is in the ballpark of $14,000. And she would also like to outfit her the area that is a kind of couch and two chairs in her entrance area to also have a workstation for those employees that may not have, maybe field personnel, don't have an assigned computer, but when there are employment-related documents that need to be completed, there's a workstation for them to utilize. And
how much is that? I'm sorry.
It's
within that 14.
Within the 14.
That's within the 14.
These are rough. I have not. She's been out for about the last week, so I have not had an opportunity to.
So that's the software package and the computer workstation with a computer and all of that. Right?
I think it's actually maybe. Why don't we amend
that
by about $1,500 for the workstation,
okay,
and some form of furniture for it to be placed on,
okay,
in that right, meeting space area.
Right.
And then she's always requesting staff support. As you know, this admin office operates with a great deal of cooperation between all of those who staff it and all of our time away from the office, whether it's for meetings that occur off premises, if they're scheduled time off for vacation or sick time. Everybody has to work together to enable the office to be staffed with a minimum of two people for safety reasons. So any staff additions, whether they are additions to the city clerk's cost center or personnel, there's still a lot of paper processing that goes on in personnel. We have applications that are submitted. There's not electronic submissions of employment applications. They are all paper and additional hands. We currently have an intern that's working with us that's been a great addition. It's a no-cost opportunity for us with a San Diego State student in her last year. Extra help always appreciated from personnel and risk management. Okay. And with that, I will hand off to planning.
Good evening, Mayor, council members. How are you doing? I want a cloning machine.
There we go.
I think everybody wants one of those.
I will share it. Other than that, like I said, I think everything's going on okay. We are expecting some turnover on the Planning Commission this year, so the new Planning Commissioners, I would like to have asking for just a little bit extra in training. We'll probably end up having it locally again. It cost us $1,000 last time. Eventually, when we win the lottery, that one day, you know, we can get a few of them to go to the actual state conference there. You got a lot more diversity on your instructors, and they get a chance to actually talk to some of the other planning commissioners from other cities and can compare their gripes. Usually, what it would cost you guys to go to like a league conference is around $1,200 with your
travel.
Airfare, your travel, your hotel, and your registration.
So that's something you haven't had been able to do?
Not for that. Yeah, it's been about 10 years since we've had one go. Yeah.
Okay.
And they're not on the commission anymore. So.
Okay.
And I think it was just, even then, I think it was just they allocated two. So, I mean, we can always rotate every couple of years. You know, we'd have to send them all seven at one time. And I don't know if all of them would be able to go at once anyway. But, you know, maybe a couple a year.
That's $1,200, and you would like for the Planning Commission to attend?
Yes,
that would be for
and
each
yourself.
One of them to
attend. Well, I have my own one. I have to go to get credits to maintain my certification.
Uh-huh.
So that one's in the fall. That's our professional organization. This one's specifically for commissioners. It's held in the spring. It's a league thing, and they do basically what you guys do. They go north-south. Oh, you know, the south one is going to be obviously cheaper because you could probably get there cheaper than if it's up in Oakland or Sacramento or whatever.
Okay.
Yeah.
How many commissioners are there?
Seven.
Probably two at a time. Two or four.
That's really all.
That's it? Thank you.
How many of them are there?
Well, it was going to cost us a little bit to clone you.
Thank you.
Yeah, that would cost.
Thank you. Yeah, that was easy. All right. So the estimated cost on that, you think, about $10,000?
To clone him?
For all seven, I would say safe number $1,700 a person because we've got the registration, hotel accommodations, mileage reimbursement, and meals.
Yeah, okay. You talk about times so seven,
12,
right?
13,000, something like that?
14,000.
Okay.
All right, good evening, Mayor, City Council. Well, first of all, this list was twice as big, and I actually had to make smaller font just to try to get within the page requirement. Didn't know that Marjo was going to have her own theme song. Police,
do you have one?
We don't have
Police
one.
Has her own theme song, as you guys see every day on TV. That's not going to happen.
Spider-Man?
So the first area in which we've done a really good job as a department in doing one-time purchases and capital purchases using special funding and grants over the last couple of years. We've been really excited about what we can offset for the city cost and to have some really good equipment. One thing in the last couple of years the department's done really well is bringing the sworn and non-sworn together and knowing how important all employees are within the police department being successful as an organization. So the first area in which that we are looking at is in personnel and services. The first individual that we would like to see sought would be, I put records clerk, but it's actually been reclassified to community service officer position. And we did that with our records just so we could cross train and start using folks in other capacities. With the growing data-driven management systems, the audits, the department activity, documentations, and mandate reporting that are becoming required, with all the paperwork that we generate with well over 38,000 calls for service a year, our records division, which consists of a records supervisor, a non-sworn supervisor, a CSO, and a rep that is out in the front, is starting to fall behind We did get some management system out of some funding that's helped them with their time management, but this would be a position that we feel that would be critical as we continue to move forward. Full burden position is approximately $52,000 a year. We moving on, we spoke of the graffiti abatement worker. We have an absolute star in our presence in regards to what this individual does out there, as he does over 1,000 paint overs on average per year. We all agreed that the general appearance of our city and the noticeable graffiti has gone way down since his employment. To add to that, the fact that we can utilize them in a couple other different capacities has been just a added bonus.
Meaning what other capacity?
We've been able to use him as a consultant and as a painter for city properties and at different levels. So,
Mr. Hendricks performed the color consultations for Main Street businesses that have to work within a particular color palette that is in the city municipal code. So he was able to meet with the property owners, describe to them what their options were, and develop a color scheme that was within the parameters of our municipal code. You might remember the asparagus building. He was instrumental in the rebirth of that paint job. He also took on our in-house project, which was the redo of the main library as well as the finance building, the repaint. He performed that work at the same time as addressing abatement needs throughout the city. So
he's a painter also then?
He is a journey level painter from the private sector we've had the benefit of employing as a temporary worker.
And did we include that in his job description, all of that?
I would be happy to discuss it with you. He's been compensated when the roles and responsibilities of his position have changed.
Okay.
That's good.
All right.
Just add him to his job description.
Now, we already saw that was a $7,000 cost, I think, to make him permanent.
Yeah.
Was it $7,000?
Yeah, it was $7,138. And I think that is money well spent in regards to the individual and the service that the city's getting.
So what would happen when he does the other jobs, though, that are not the graffiti abatement?
It
would still
be compensated.
He'll get compensated separately?
Yeah, that's a side note or with when he works in that capacity.
Right, and he likely wouldn't in the future, right?
We need to work through several matters that involve this individual, his classification, his potential union representation. Right now he is a temporary worker that has assignments as made by chief or city manager.
Yeah, there would have to be some work done, I think, on that.
Primarily, it's almost all going to be graffiti abatement at this time, and it's when these things move forward. So, the next position would be a dispatcher one position. Currently, we have 8 dispatchers and 1 part-time dispatcher. Each shift requires 2 dispatchers. We have 4 patrol shifts, so all 8 dispatchers are spoken for. They work 12-hour shifts, which creates a 4-hour overtime window for each employee every pay period. This allows us the most resource for the manpower that we have. The part-time position was created and has actually worked very well for us in regards to being able to cover that overtime, also filling in for long illnesses and sick leave, and covering vacations. By using this person, and we have them at 12 hours a week, 25 hours a pay period to be within the Affordable Care Act, they do that 25 hours plus they cover 20 hours of vacation that the other dispatchers will take. With not having to fill that with overtime, this employee is under $10,000 a year to do that. However, that being said, it's very difficult when you're only allowing someone to work 12 hours a week to hang on to people. We've been fortunate enough to bring our part-time dispatchers up to full-time positions when we have vacancies, or they'll leave outright. And so we can still have the benefit of covering the overtime and having a full-time employee. I will also remind that the selection process, the training, the investment that the city has in this type of position is very extensive. So to have to redo that on a regular basis becomes problematic. Currently, the full burden for a full-time dispatcher, one position is $54,000. The part-time dispatcher is $17,000. And so the difference cost of the full burden would be $36,000 per year. Moving on, we identified an IT assistant. We have an IT department of one for the entire city. Although he does an absolute great job for us and trying to get to all of our needs and to work on some future projects that we have, and certainly social media is one, and some of the capital projects that we have in the queue and trying to get them done. The day-to-day grind of maintenance on and just software that all the departments are requiring, it pulls him away from doing that, and it's hard to keep him within those timelines. We reached out to see what a full-time IT assistant position for his department would be, and the full burden would be $63,000. That came from ICOE. So, and finally, in personnel, I have is two full-time police officers position. As stated earlier with some of the other departments, approximately 5-6 years ago, we had 38 sworn. Currently, our department with non-sworn is 51 individuals. We had 38 sworn. We're down to 33 sworn, but then we were able to hire the two for SROs, so we're at 35. As mentioned, we're in the middle of a partnership with the grant and with the schools to do a split on their salaries. We're going in, part of that grant was in year four, we would do a 50-50 split between the city and the schools. When that's over, though, we have those two positions. Now, we have had a turnover that we are pretty confident that we can absorb those positions. However, I will state that those positions right now currently is our positions we feel are very valuable where they are within the schools. And certainly, we believe that the school would be interested in working with us to continue some type of partnership in this. So this one actually could be put off for another year, since we have another year on the books in regards to this grant. Speaking of moving on to the second item, and these will go pretty fast, on-site relocation of the city's IT department. The police department, although we've done some really great renovations over there, it's still somewhat of a Rubik's Cube in regards to trying, if you want to expand your units. We do house the city IT department there. We did look at some off-site locations to move our city IT. There was some problematic issues in that. We love having him there. I will tell you from our department, the police department is a hub for the IT and our daily interaction with them, and we have overview or oversight. We did look into in the very west portion of our parking lot where the west gate is, we no longer use. We could bring in a modular office building that would be fully customizable for our extreme weather here, and the specs would be that we could bring it in, trunk it into the building with all the connectivity, the electrical, and the Cat 6 lines and all needed. The estimated cost for the total install from plans to delivery would be just under $100,000 for that that building.
That includes the modular itself?
That is the entire.
The whole cost.
It's the entire thing.
Is there a brand new module?
Brand new. And this would be with the upgrades in regards to the BTUs on the air conditioner, the extended maintenance, and with the 2x6 construction for the added insulation for our heat. especially when a lot of our IT equipment would be housed in there. Moving to the next item that we would have, the department would be interested in exploring the option of purchasing the northeast corner of the adjacent apartment complex. There is a section of that apartment complex that, their parking lot that is not being utilized very much. Although we haven't had an opportunity to get a hold of the owner, there has been some conversation that they might be interested. Have spoken a little bit with our planning, our building department in regards to what their off-street need parking is, and because it was built in 1972, he believes that we would be able to purchase that without hindering their ability to have off-street parking. This would expand our rear lot. Right now, if you don't recall, or I'm sure most of you do, that there was a time where there wasn't a rear lot. It was the alley that just went right through between where the cars were parked. And so there was some good movement on that to secure that. But by adding approximately this area, we could add 20 to 25 parking stalls, move our employee parking out of the front, which allows some off-street parking for our community to that visit the police station. So, and it would also add much-needed security for our vehicles. Again, as I don't have what the cost of acquiring the property would be, the estimated, on top of that, there was both parking lots would need a resurfacing. And based on the cost that just occurred at fire, we estimated that between $80,000 and $90,000 for the resurfacing of both lots total. Report writing room upgrades. The department would be looking to purchase two banks of emergency gear lockers. There would be 16 each. They're 24 by 18 by 24. They would allow the officers to put their emergency gear in without having to lug them upstairs, taking risks of being injured with the heavy gears up and down stairs, and they'd be more accessible. Doing so, we'd also like to purchase some furnishings in regards to desk and partitions that would make that space more beneficial for the actual report writing task. The estimated cost of the lockers is $14,000. The estimated cost of the furnishings is $3,500.
$3,500?
Yes.
$35,000.
$35,000,
sorry.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. And the final item that we have here is the parking lot security lighting project. Currently, all the lights underneath the shade structures and on the large power poles are fluorescent or outdated lights. We're recommending replacing those with the energy efficient LEDs. The efficiency would be a higher quality, lower cost, and would provide better security. The estimated cost of, I put gear locker on mine, but it's actually on the lights fully installed was $9,500. That's all I have. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chief.
Our last presentation.
Yeah.
Public Works.
Good evening.
Good evening.
There is not much left, right?
So. There's no money left. No.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, Council Members. Guillermo Sillas, Interim Public Works Director. The list, the first project that I have on the list is the acquisition of a new vehicle for the Animal Control Division. Due to the existing one, has more than 100,000 miles and reach its useful life. And it's used for all-day driving and long trips to the Humane Society. The vehicle is model 2006. And just to give you some of the numbers on repairs, during the last 2 years, we spent about $20,000 in repairs. And the cost of the new vehicle would be about $70,000. Including the cage that is needed with the air conditioner and a lift platform to help to raise the animals and to easily put it on inside the cage. Some other numbers that I would like to share with you is the average of the animals that he captures per year, it's about 422 cats per year, about 695 dogs per year, for a total of 1,116 animals per year. So the second project that I would like to share is to install a lobby security window at Public Works office. And this is to protect the secretary or front desk person from people that is that disagree with the city employees enforcing city policies and regulations. The cost will be approximately $50,000.
Have you had issues with that?
Some incidents before with people that get inside the building and start looking around and asking for who is this person, or asking questions with no business there. Mm-hmm. And also people that is angry because the animal control officer captured his animal. And they are demanding, and sometimes we have to call the police department, you know, to calm these people.
Okay.
I got that.
Thank you.
The third one would be continue with the rehabilitation of the public works yard. We have a project or a concept design for six phases. And so we would like to continue with the phases 3 and 4, which is the area where they store the materials for the normal operations, like sand-based material and some material that they during demolitions, or like pipes where they did excavations, or material that they will be using for repairs and backfill on the streets. So the cost is about $500,000, because
that's
it's
for phase 3 and 4 that would complete the whole thing.
No, we are in this fiscal year we budgeted $250,000 for the same purpose for phases 1, 5, and 6. So we have six phases. So we will be doing, or we want to do in this fiscal year, the next one will be phases 3 and 4, and will be left the phase number 2.
So how much are we talking about?
$500,000.
For what you want to do this year?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Extra.
Okay.
All right. Got it.
And the last one would be remove and replace the fence of the old water treatment plant adjacent to the public works yard. The cost would be approximately $140,000. This project is to improve the aesthetics of this abandoned facility, which is located on a residential area and along the access point of the city, which is the Highway 86.
To remove the fence?
Remove and replace and install some plastic material that block the view, you know, toward inside the facility, which is not very pleasant.
Screen fencing.
It's a screen, exactly.
We actually do the whole thing, but, yeah. Okay.
Right.
It'd be nice if we could get rid of it.
Make some money.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So hopefully, by hearing from each of the departments, you can appreciate how hard it is in the budget process. We have many, many, many concepts that are in the mix that, prior to reaching the council, as a proposal, many don't make it to the table because of the size of the projects, the ongoing expenses associated with retention of employees, and some of the struggles that we have to simply maintain the personnel and the operational costs on an annual basis. So I want to thank the staff. They haven't had the chance to dream for a while, and it's wonderful. What we want to make sure that we convey is that we see lots and lots of work that needs to be performed out there, but we're fiscally constrained. Right. And the fiscal constraints are what really holds us back from doing all the great work we'd love to do if we had a few more bodies and a few more dollars devoted to projects.
But this is also good because for all the people that watch, you know, this, the meetings, you know, they later on down the line, they do watch it. I get lots of compliments about that. And it's good for them to understand what it is, what we're faced, you know, what each department needs, you know, what their needs are, and yet we can't give everything. But hopefully, if we decide to go the way we've been talking about, this will help them to understand what it is and what we're trying to do for our city. Okay?
Just Mr. Mayor, if we could, while we're on the topic, I know at the last meeting we met, I had mentioned $1 million for improvement projects. And of course, that doesn't include additional staff. I just wanted to see if we could invest that money into the various departments. And obviously, there's a long list that adds up to multiple millions of dollars here today.
What did you get? I have 2.8 million.
Okay. Well, I made a list of things that I want the council to consider, okay? And it totals less than $1 million, and I want to see if we can move forward with the approval this year. So the city clerk is requesting $10,000 for laser fish upgrades. Community development, although I didn't have the full figure outlined, I would like to give them $20,000 for equipment purchases or other repairs that are necessary. That's the only department that I didn't have anything specific for. Finance, $32,000 for computer replacement and office supplies. The fire department, $210,000 for breathing apparatus. A library, $6,800 for computer equipment.
Wait a minute. How much for the equipment apparatus?
$210,000.
Okay.
Library, $6,800 for computer equipment. Parks and Rec, I would like to fund the restroom repairs and the pool repairs. So that would total $550,000. Personnel and Risk, $15,000 for workstation and software. Planning, I'd like to give them $13,000 for training of the planning commissioners. Police, $17,500 for lockers and furniture. And Public Works, $70,000 for vehicle and the animal control vehicle. That total is $954,300. And so these would be one-time commitments. They're not for, with the exception, I should mention that, I mentioned it earlier, with the exception of the temporary position that's in the senior center and the graffiti abatement position, I would like to see those become full-time. But this is the list of items based on the feedback from staff that I would like to see funded. It totals less than $1 million, and it would be capital improvement repairs that are sorely needed within the community. So I realize we've been very, very conservative over the past several years. And in years past, just for a little reflection, in years past, we actually had to use over $1 million just to continue with services, and that wasn't even providing any improvement within the community. So I'd like the council to consider the items that staff has listed. And I know we've mentioned making some one-time improvements. I think this would be a very good position and time to do it. So that's my comment.
And Councilmember Nava, I'd like to thank you for the feedback. I do want to make note of one matter that is probably of importance to the council, and that is that between the strategic planning meeting date and preparation for today's meeting, these wish lists were prepared. Many of them were prepared in the absence of our personnel administrator, who is critical in identifying the cost of employees. So I want to give you that caveat. And also note that many of the figures, they're estimates.
We understand.
And we would love to be able to work more extensively to hone in on the numbers and also absolutely determine, is the general fund the only option to fund these activities? Yeah. Are there any other special funds that are a match for the type of work that's proposed? One other item I know, and I'm sorry, Mayor.
I'm sorry. Did you say there are no other funds?
She said they would like to check.
Would like to vet it in that fashion, because these were not project concepts that had hours and hours devoted to them as part of the budget process. We'll also note that many of these acquisitions do take time to accomplish, and so I ask for the council's patience as the number of personnel aren't increasing to pursue these projects, that it could be very challenging with the existing manpower to meet expectations in a single fiscal year.
We understand. It's only $1 million. It's not five. It's not 10. So we understand. Yeah. And not all departments are asking for $200,000.
Before that, and this is more of a direction thing, and I appreciate Councilmember Nava, you know, doing some summary there. Of course, you know, I want to hear other council input as well. What I would recommend, that regardless of what, as we move on beyond this, is that this comes back to us at another meeting where we have a little bit more, obviously, qualification and staff time. This list may change, right? Some of these projects could, you know, change. Maybe a cost estimate was off, or our ability to deliver. Maybe it's something for a future consideration. But I think, in principle, the idea is if we can move forward. And that was my two cents on this was, the only thing I would be leery about with this general fund workshop discussion is our current, which you very well outlined, revenue to expenditure, what the future projection looks like, some of the other discussion we had in the strategy workshop. We just don't want to get ourselves in a situation where our expenditures are outpacing our revenues. And I think we're pretty well agreed upon that. This right here, where there's some capital expenditures, which what I'm hearing is things can become more efficient, right? We're talking about computer systems, we're talking about furniture, ergonomics, we're also talking about public improvements with restrooms, parks, all this. I mean, some of these are bare essentials. So if we can qualify this list, and maybe we can agree, and I'd like to hear from Councilmember Noriega, if you had some thought as well from your notes. Or
I was glad Rosanna brought the fact that maybe there's other monies, other places. That was my first thought.
Yeah.
You know, have we looked in to see if we can get some other monies in to help us out with these, especially the more important ones, the apparatus for the safety. Absolutely. And there's others. But I would like to see them do a little bit more in depth and see if they can come up with other monies.
Is there an agreement on, I think the concept behind the list was to take at least some of the tangible projects out of each department and see what we can deliver.
Yeah.
Now, are we also in agreement on the staffing? Because there were several staffing augmentation proposals in here as well. We're comfortable with the fact that that's going to be a challenge for us, I think, under the current fund budget that's being proposed.
And the expiration of the utility user tax in 2018.
That's another issue.
That's another issue that we haven't even tackled. And the other one is the fact that we are still under negotiations with several bargaining unions.
Yes.
So those assumptions have not been put in. So there's still yet more to come on that. So I think what I'm comfortable with is what was proposed by Councilmember Nava is the fact that these are CapEx. These are projects. These are one-time. For the most part, everything there was a one-time purchase. They're upgrades, and they're probably stuff that sorely needed to be done anyway. So,
and some may have made their way into the budget process anyway as a result of being brought forward in the process. So you're aware there were elements of each of the departments that were the absolute critical. For instance, our fire chief's presentation of the breathing apparatus that was part of, if there nothing else goes, this is really important to our personnel.
Absolutely.
So each department had those types of requests.
And again, I'd like to see the community involved in this for them to understand what we're looking at so that when the other
I have a comment in regards to, well, because I realize that for Parks and Recreation, the swimming pool is vital to, I mean, for the community. But since it is shared by all the schools and Brawley High School and others, is that a possibility also to look into shared costs, sharing the cost?
2 years ago, we actually entered into MOUs with both of the school districts. Mm-hmm. It has not been the historical form. With regard to capital improvements, we tried a very, very modest approach with each of the school districts, which did require an adjustment on all of our stakeholders' parts to join us in valuing the pool and contributing to its maintenance, since the high school and school district don't have, the elementary school district don't have their own pools, and they use our pools during certain months of the year, and those are the months of the year in which they do some cost sharing on maintenance related duties. I would also be remiss to leave out that the elementary school district, during the period of time that school children visit the pool as part of their daily activities, they actually supply the lifeguards. And that was part of an arrangement in the past where it was very challenging for the city to go through the recruitment process for lifeguards and then cover the expense of those personnel during outside hours to ensure that class time was devoted to pool use. So there's been kind of a give and take, and the council was supportive of the cost sharing. The boards of those institutions have been supportive, but it's because so much of the trade-off has always been, hey, how about we come and help with your maintenance of parks and help with Weiss Field and upgrade, find you donors to upgrade those facilities. I think in some ways they're kind of the unspoken trade-off for other arrangements that all serve the public and residents of Brawley.
So perhaps we could talk to them and see if there maybe there's a possibility that they could share in this type of a cost. Maybe they have some kind of funding available or a grant. Maybe grants may be available.
I don't know if that would even be possible, though, because we own the asset. We own the Lyon Center, and so I don't know if they would be able to.
I don't see it as a likely, but we're certainly open to exploring options. I grants are always great if you can find the perfect match.
Yeah, because there are sharing grants. That are out there.
I appreciate Councilman Nava's list, and I think I agree with many of the things that he said. However, I think we need to vet it a little bit more, make sure that we get some more information. I think if we're going to decide, I think as a council, then we have to decide, are we going to go to 1 million? Are we going to go to half a million? What do we really want to do here? And a lot of that depends upon some other things we'll get from the budget, I think, as we work our way along. One of the other things I want everybody to understand, I think that from the department head side and from the city manager side, I do expect maybe some recommendations on some of those areas where you're going to think, where you're going to have a discussion with the department head, and the department head's going to tell you, look, we got to have this right now. I think there are some things, since they are wish lists, we push forward to additional years, or we go to next year, or we do whatever we need to do with that. Maybe some things we partially fund and some things we fund over the span of a 2 or 3 year period.
You've
here.
But
I think, especially because like the plastering of the pool, where it's $500,000. I mean, I think that's something maybe we don't want to take on in any just single year. And it's something that we have to maybe put aside that in reserves and hold that money for 2 or 3 years and then do the job. But I think that's what we need to really look at. And I don't know how long the plaster will last. I think everybody goes through that where the plaster starts to deteriorate. I don't know how far along it is. I don't know all those details.
We're pretty far along for the last two budget cycles, at least. We've highlighted this upcoming investment that's going to be required. And if we don't meet the minimum standard, the shutdown is the alternative, which obviously isn't desired. I'll share with you that the smaller scale items, some of them are actually included in here. This really small, not the expansion of activities, but the core, let's say we have ergonomic complaints and workman's comp claims in a particular department. Equipment, where it's not going to be an option to delay replacement of the office furniture.
We understand.
So those types, that's when we do the sorting for high risk.
And if we can have that sorted list out, but I just want to remind council and the rest of staff, we've been very conservative with our capital improvements, and these are things that we've delayed for quite some time. We won't do this every year. We know that. Yep. And so I understand that the desire to want to spread things out, but we are in probably the best position that we've been in many, many years. And so if we're going to do something, I really would want to see us move forward with a very comprehensive list of items that we're going to try to improve throughout the community. So just keeping that in mind, again, I will just reemphasize the fact that we don't do this every year. We've been fiscally conservative, and there are improvements that need to be made throughout our community. And I think right now is the opportune time to be able to do those one-time improvements.
So what I'm hearing is that we'd like to get back a little bit more of a vetted list. Again, we understand it's not going to be right to the dollar or penny on every project, because there's quite a bit of work to do on that. But if we can take the proposed list, if we're in high agreement,
the short list as described.
The short list as described. If there's any further input on the list, then feel free.
I just had a question on for the for Francisco's recommendations, which one was the one that you recommended?
There wasn't anything in particular. I just didn't want to leave that department out, but the rest of the departments, I had something that he described. The one position that he described was well beyond, it was a position request, so it wasn't, that's not something that I was considering, so.
Okay, okay. But you did say there was an amount for his.
Said $20,000.
$20,000, okay.
And on the union negotiations, how are we, how far are we into that, and how long are we looking to
finalize?
I would be happy to, we've got a closed session item that I'd be happy to brief you on in a closed session.
So we don't have any time?
Negotiations have commenced. The hope is that they'll conclude in time for budget adoption, so that all costs can be accounted for in budget adoption May 19th.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you.
At least we can estimate. One other point. I think that what I need to see is like Councilman Nava's list, and then I need to be able to vet that with what has been requested here, and I've got most of my notes on what's been requested. And then I think essentially as a council, we're going to agree on some type of list where we fund some of these items. And I think that's very clear that we're interested in doing that. So all I need, but I can't tell from what was stated from I don't have a list in front of me, and I'd like to be able to look at that and see.
We'd be happy to narrow the list of requests. If I could kindly repeat it, would that be possible, just to be sure that I've got it
that's fine
properly accounted for? So Laserfish acquisition, $20,000 set aside for community development services improvements. Finance related request for equipment. Fire department fire apparatus at 210, or I think it was 208. Yeah. Library related equipment purchases at 6,800.
Yes.
Restroom repairs with a supply budget of 50,000, performing it in-house. Pool repairs up to 550, so the plaster plus the mechanical related issues. Mm-hmm. The personnel department's request for a software solution and a workstation. Mm-hmm. A $13,000 rough a travel and training budget for planning commissioners.
Yes.
Okay. The police lockers, gear lockers project, is that?
Right.
And then.
And the report writing furniture.
And then another look at making permanent the senior center coordinator position, as well as the graffiti abatement worker position, making those permanent. And that we will, between now and the next time it
and
comes
the public,
to you.
I'm sorry to interrupt. The public works vehicle for animal control?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Animal control.
Yes. Yeah. I'm keeping my fingers crossed that we may have another funding source for that.
No, perfect. That would be that would be great.
And thank
you
for catching.
Did you get the city clerk?
The city clerk was Laserfish.
You got it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes. With the three, that's just three licenses.
Okay. Is council comfortable? We'll move forward with that list to come back to us for further specific viewing.
So the next workshop is going to be special and enterprise funds, which means we'll take all of the special funds, talk about what projects are still in the queue to go, and what might be considered by the council for the future. We also have quite a few business items on the next agenda, including the water sewer capacity fees topic, as well as the development impact fees topic, and the five-year report of the use of impact fees. Maybe the best meeting, if the council is open, and I'm going to look to our finance director for any major objections, between there is one regular city council meeting date between the special and enterprise funds workshop and the overall budget adoption. Would the council be open to seeing final numbers for the general fund? Do you want to see it at the special and enterprise funds, or do you want to see it at the first meeting in May?
May 3rd. The 3rd of May was on.
3rd of May.
The
3rd of May.
Is that
the
preference?
Yeah. Okay. Would the council be open to hearing a report back on this particular lineup and associated costs at the first meeting in May?
That's fine.
Yes.
Fine.
That's fine.
And then your guidance will drive the assumptions for final budget adoption on May 19th, first meeting in May. Okay.
I just want to thank staff and council for the consideration. Thank you.
Thanks.
Mr. Mayor, I'm just concerned with the main meeting that we're going to have the next meeting when we discuss the the non-general fund items. We're going to also have all these developers here. We're going to have other people, and I don't mind them listening in and all that, but it just makes for a very, very lengthy meeting for them and for us. And I'm concerned about that. I think that's a lot on our schedule.
I think some of the challenge is that there was not wasn't the consensus of the council to have additional meeting dates. So how would you like us to manage that? Because the notices have gone out to all the developers regarding the 19th.
The 19th is the meeting that we've scheduled for that. Right?
I'd be willing to have a separate meeting. I don't know.
I was thinking a separate meeting on budget might be better, simply because we have more time to digest the budget items and discuss those budget items. Because otherwise, we're going to it's all going to be compacted in there. We're going to have a bunch of people in the audience. We're going to have.
I'll share with you that on the enterprise funds, we have lots of projects that are still in the queue. Major water and wastewater projects that are underway. So historically, our discussions haven't been extensive when it pertains to the special and enterprise funds.
I
thought there was going to be a lot of discussion like there was today, but you don't foresee a lot of discussion.
Because 120 employees fall into this category at general fund, the number remaining for water and sewer is far fewer.
There's not much you can do with that anyway. I mean, it's pretty much set.
Right, and the capital projects, as you know, with Yasmin's departure, the 49 deliverables in her work plan are partially delivered, but there's quite a few that
we'll be handling that at the end of the agenda.
We can,
because
yes.
Because we're going to go
like
through with the public. It'll be here, and we don't want to necessarily
make
this. They have to set it for hours. I mean, I don't think that's a good idea. Okay.
Very good. Let's move on to our next.
Did you want to talk about the other contributions or just leave as is? These were our assumptions from last fiscal year, and I assume we're rolling over for all of our contributions.
They've been there for several years, so.
Right. We're fine with it? Okay.
Yeah. So we're okay.
Okay, perfect.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Rosanna and staff, everyone, for taking the time. Hopefully we move forward with that, and I will move on to item number 6, which will be departmental reports. 6A is monthly staffing report, April 2016. Shirley Bonillas, who is not with us today, personnel and risk.
A brief overview. You'll see it, I think it's the last page of our packet here, page 69. We've got our vacant positions noted. We have one current vacant position in the police department, but we've got a new officer swearing in on April 12th. We hope you'll join us for that occasion. We do have the new officer coming for an introduction. April 12th, 2016 is the new officer swearing in. And that new officer, as is our common practice, we bring the new officer to a city council meeting to introduce him or her to the council and the community. And then in Public Works, we have two current openings, and we now have a third as of the publication of this, which is the vacated Public Works Director position. So we're currently going through a recruitment for a utility worker two that's in-house, and we recently had a vacated position as an equipment mechanic, and then position has been advertised. We've had quite a few folks walking in. And down to Parks and Rec, you'll see our normal use of temporary personnel that are identified, as well as PD and Public Works that also utilize temp workers.
Okay.
And that's all I have to report.
Very good. Item 7 will be our city council members' reports. We'll begin with Council Member Noriega.
I don't really have anything to report out, but I would like to see sometime soon to have a discussion on the building on 8th and G Street. What is it we're going to do? What is the county going to do? What are we doing? Where are we? I do believe that we've sat on it for a long time, and I do believe that revenue we've lost just having it sit there. I believe at one point it was going to cost another $60,000 to get it knocked down. I know that there's people out there that want to build something there, but don't, again, want to pay the $60,000 to get it. So just kind of think about that. if we can.
Would be happy to bring that back to a closed session discussion. It was on the agenda in the last 60 days, but I'd be happy to provide you with a revisit of that topic. The estimated value of demo was about 200,000. Yes.
What's left, you mean?
Correct.
And I would share with you, Councilmember Noriega, I did have a short discussion with a developer that's actually building in the city of Brawley and purchasing buildings, and they've expressed interest in that facility. So,
yeah, we've got quite a few people that are interested.
But this group has purchased multiple properties, so.
Okay. They're in the process of purchasing, or they're?
They have. Yeah,
they have already? Oh, good.
So maybe it'll get handled.
Not that specific property, other properties, right?
They've purchased other properties.
Other properties. Yeah.
But they're interested in this particular property.
Councilmember Noriega, is that it?
I'm done.
Okay, thank you. Councilmember Howdige?
I did attend. I was real pleased to be able to join the group that came from Sacramento and from throughout the state, representing the Air Resources Board and the Environmental Justice Advisory Committee. They came in on Sunday, and basically the majority of them, I would say, were not familiar with Imperial County or Imperial Valley, so they wanted to tour the area and see what kind of environmental issues we have, and of course there's plenty for them to see. So we took them for a drive, and we also showed them the transit center that have been built here and in El Centro, and what has been done by the Imperial County
Transportation
Commission. Then we went all the way to the border so they could see a lot of the issues there with the fumes, you know, from the vehicles, and a car stopped there and for 2 or 3 hours. And so they got to see plenty of the issues that we have here in Imperial County, and they, I think they were, I don't want to say impressed, but I guess impressed is an okay word, with a lot of the things that are possible to do for us and to work with the representatives from Brawley and Imperial County. Then the following day, they had their committee meeting out here. I was happy to see that they accepted the invitation, you know, to come and meet in Brawley. And they, the initial part of it, I think it was kind of laying the groundwork on where they were. But after they got going, they did talk quite a bit about all the areas of concern, not just here, but throughout the state. And I was impressed with the funding that's been allocated actually by the agency. And they gave us a detail of all the money that's been put out there. And some of them are, well, one of the governor took a big chunk, and that was for the high-speed rail. But after that, there's a lot of money available for areas like ours for housing, weatherization and solar energy efficiency, water energy efficiency, and so on. And so they had a list on the map of where all the money has gone in the past years. I think a lot of us were disappointed that in Imperial County there was only two projects in this past fiscal year. So I think there's going to be an emphasis on pursuing some funding to work on some of these issues here in Imperial County. And which kind of brought me to think that, and I know we just went through this budget exercise and we didn't ask Rosanna what her wish list was, so.
I wish for a balanced budget.
But almost everything that we attend, you know, even at Sacramento level and state level, and then when these committees come out, they're always talking about all this funding that's available and all these grants that are available. And it just made me wonder if we're really taking advantage and of all the opportunities to apply for these grants. And so I thought it might be a good idea to ask, just as something that maybe if we can't do it now, maybe we can do it in the future, as a possibility of either maybe a part-time grant writer or somebody to assist Rosanna to pursue these things. Because I, in my mind, I'm just wondering how many grants have we applied for, you know, from each department, and how many have been successful, and is there any room out
millions
there for
and millions of dollars of grant applications, many, most so. Many of which team effort were applicants for, many led by Yasmin Arellano, right. Millions of dollars.
And that's the other thing too, that I know we've lost, you know, a very valuable person, and I know we have a good person that's taken her place. But it just, you know, just kind of something that I'm curious about, are we taking full advantage of all the opportunities there are to apply for funds? And maybe we could direct staff to just bring us a report, maybe for the past fiscal year, how many grants we applied for, how much money we got, and that way all of us will kind of know where the money's coming from and what other opportunities there may be out there. Because they really did emphasize that there's money there from the Air Resources Board. And I know that we've actually taken advantage of some, right, from them?
Not the Air
Local, the no. local ACPD.
Oh, yeah.
So, I mean, I came away with that, and I think it's a great opportunity for us to attend these so that we can see those opportunities and possibly for the department heads also. I know that you, as department heads, do probably stay on top of that, but there may be some other opportunities there that we may miss, and we don't want to do that.
Yes. I think many of our challenges are that the pipeline is full. We have many grant commitments. For instance, Alice Giroux Park, $2.7 million grant award. It's been in the queue for 2+ years. So we have large projects that we need to deliver that have dollars associated with them. So the hard part is to conduct the chase for the new grant opportunities at the same time that the same number of personnel are trying to push the projects through the pipeline. So it's a hard juggling exercise, but you know I think there's a lot of we have a competitive edge in many funding sources. Mm-hmm. It's just how do you keep the projects moving at the same time as keeping an eye out on the big picture for what is on the horizon.
Well, I just see an opportunity. If there's more money, there's more opportunity for more staff, you know, and new more projects, you know, to complete more projects. So. I personally would like to request the report. I know that it'll take maybe a little bit of time, but maybe if someone could prepare that for us, I would appreciate
that. I'd be happy
that.
To do it.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
Very good. Thank you, Councilmember Howdy. Councilmember Nava?
I'll just keep it really brief. The employee appreciation banquet that we had, wonderful event. Congratulations to all of staff, and I really want to thank the employee appreciation committee that help put that together. I know that they had done a lot of work the night prior, and they were still missing an element of a wow element, and so they went in and did that at the very last minute, but it really was impressive and really intimate. It was a lot different than being at the Line Center. Line Center is pretty big and you know, a lot of space in between tables and everything else, but I enjoyed it very much, and I think the rest of the council did as well.
Yes,
and you know, it's really great to see staff out there, some with being awarded for 35 years of service within the city, I think is very impressive. So congratulations to all of you, and thank you for all the work that you do.
Very good. Thank you, Councilmember Nava. Mayor Pro Tem Couchman.
Well, I also wanted to comment that I did enjoy the Employees Appreciation Luncheon. It was a great event. We were all in there. I think all the council members were there, and I think it went really, really well. Everybody had a good time, and I thought the employees enjoyed it also. Food was good. I mean, everything went really, really smoothly. Attended Little League Barbecue this weekend. That was a well-attended event. It's held at our Lions Center. So Little League does, I think, very well with that event. They sell a lot of tickets. The kids help serve, and it's a great event for the community. A lot of people were there, and I think they sell a lot of tickets to that. So, and it's at our Lions Center. I think that's important that we showcase that and make sure that the city is a contributor to those types of functions here in our lovely city. Other than that, I really don't have a whole lot to report other than the fact that there's a lot of events coming up. I think Hidalgo Society has an event. MAG has an event, I believe. We're going to have Dancing with the Stars for IVRLP. There's a variety of different events going on right now, and I see a whole bunch of things happening in the next month or so. So I hope everybody's prepared for that, and I wish everybody success at their events. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem Couchman. And just a couple things just to echo staff luncheon. So thank you to all my council members. That was a fantastic event with us, and obviously with staff just does a tremendous job. And I know the committee that actually comes together to put that together seems to keep taking it up a notch. So it was very enjoyable. Just attended for a short while, about an hour and a half, to the Environmental Justice Advisory Committee for an introduction. And I echo some of the comments that Councilmember Howdy said. With that, I would like to yield the remainder of my few minutes. I did not mean to bypass, but would our supervisor like to come up and make a few comments?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So, Marjo, my theme song is Stayin' Alive.
That's a good one.
But you have to sing it.
That would be fun.
It was the song I used. It was a song, but in Spanish, that I did Dancing with the Stars.
Oh, that's right. That's true.
And I thought you won.
Salsa. Yeah.
I thought you won.
Well, when I did it, I thought I won, too. So.
It's been a while.
We all think we won.
Yeah. No, I thought he won.
No, you didn't. Yeah. You haven't done it yet, so.
You'd be surprised what we see.
So, thank you, Mr. Mayor, Council, City Staff. I did want to make you aware that on Monday, the 11th at 6 p.m., there will be a joint IID Imperial County workshop at Palmer Auditorium. The Assistant Secretary for Salt and Sea Policy of the Natural Resources Agency, Bruce Wilcox, who you're familiar with, mm-hmm. will be speaking. Valerie Simon, the Salt and Sea Program Manager for the Bureau of Reclamation, will also be speaking. And Phil Rosentrater from the Salt and Sea Authority will be speaking. A year ago at this time, we were preparing to make our case in front of the State Water Resources Board. At this time, you'll be able to hear all the things that have taken place in that past 12 months, the effects, and the amount of activity that still needs to be done. There's been a lot of movement, but the amount of action is lacking. So, please join us at Palmer on Monday night, and it will be a question and answer after their presentation. So there will be displays that you'll be able to see the ownership of the sea, who owns what pieces, a new detailed map from the Bureau of Reclamation. There will also be some other informational items to help prompt some questions that you'll have. And then a week from Tuesday, the 19th of today's the 19th of April. Yeah. Staying Awake should be my theme song.
There you go.
The 19th of April will be the State Water Resources Board. They are having quarterly meetings now on the Salt Sea progress. And on March 31st, Assemblymember Garcia's bill, AB 1095, required that Salt Sea projects that were shovel ready be identified on March 31st. Those projects are identified. I've seen the list. It is lacking some information, and I'll let them share it with you on Monday. But one specific thing that upsets me is that if you attended the Red Hill ceremony in November, it was stated at that ribbon cutting that Species Conservation Habitat 1 would begin in January of 2016. They now have it on a schedule to begin in January 2017. Mm. This is a fully funded project. It's been fully funded for 5 years. So, I'll leave
what
you that.
Time
I
is
hope
that?
To see you.
What time
6
is
o'clock on Monday.
Thank you very much, Supervisor Kelly, for that briefing. And that will carry us over to the next item, which will be our city manager's report.
Nothing at this time.
Very good. Thank you. And city attorney's report.
Things have been pretty quiet. I think everybody, city staff, is busy with their budget. So I've been working on the conflict of interest code that Alma's been after me to take care of. The other thing is we're 6 weeks away from the gallery night at Del Rio. If you haven't been before, it's my wife's thing she puts on every year. There's no ticket involved. You just show up.
I've been.
There's a silent auction of artwork. You're not obligated to buy a lot of it. Only mom and grandma would buy, but a lot of it's really good.
I have.
You buy.
I'm sure you have. And we always make the kids donate a portion of whatever they earn, 20%, to Wounded Warriors, and it's spent in Imperial Valley. Every dime that we donate stays here. It goes through the local guys. So it's open to everybody, the staff and everybody. It's just, you just show up. It's at Del Rio, and it's really fun.
When is it?
And that's when?
May 20th, Friday night.
Very good.
Thank you.
And we'll finish up with item 10, which is our city clerk's report. With an item, we'll move on to item 11, which will be closed session. We'll take a brief few minutes before we move into closed session. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I know.